Alpha the Learn Elf for each state for tonight for the Monroe Academy Volunteer. Number one, Hunter Glass. Number two, Peyton Powell. Number three, Phelan Stallworth. Number four, Jake McKenzie. Number seven, Jack Vermilion. Number eight, Daniel Whitehead. Number 10, Briar Settle. Number 11, Justin Rowell. Number 12, Blaine Lee. Number 14, Caleb Sessions. Number 15, Cole Griffin. Number 16, Caleb Smith. Number 18, Ethan Nall. Number 20, Colt Carroll. Number 22, Brandon McKinley. Number 24, Connor Morgan. Number 25, Dylan Whitman. Number 30, Craig Bryan. Number 38, Gus McKenzie. Number 44, Dallas Nichols. Number 51, J.L. Gaston. Number 53, James Ellis. Number 55, Watson Kennedy. Number 56, Jonathan Simpson. Number 58, Malcolm Hughes. Number 60, Austin Jordan. Number 61, Joe Walker.
Okay, whatever you say, because I tried to call him and...
Nothing else, I'll put him in your email and send it to him.
74, Alex Robinson. 75, Cameron Pratcher. Number 77, Jacob Johnson. Number 78, Logan Helton. And number 81...
See, I showed Bessemer being 1 and 3, and he's got him at 2 and 2. So I wonder which one of these is correct.
Now for your 2012 Best Rock Academy Row.
What is the
number one?
There.
Number two,
Jeremy
Layton. Number four, Ernie O'Brien. Number 22,
not much.
Chris
we're all good to go, but Mark's got a couple questions.
Number seven, Elijah Moore.
Okay.
Number eight, Noah Napier. Number 11, Jake Merritt. Number 12, Alex Hahn. Number 15, Matt Tiger. Number 17, Jared Brewer. Number 18, Ernie O'Brien.
Man, you stepped up.
Wait a minute.
You did. You stepped up.
Man.
Man is saying tonight.
Yeah, you got the 3-0 and 1-3. So that's what we're going
to go with. 25, Scott Norris. 24, Number 45, Bailey Steve.
Oh, that's
number
50, Drew Brown. I'm
sorry. 51, Darius Roberts. Number 52,
Testing. Charlie, can you hear that?
Number 72, Josh Booth. Number 73,
okay,
Wilson.
All right,
number 67, Tyler Scazzaro.
All right.
Number 81,
bye.
Wade Garrett. Number 83, Ben Gibson.
Thanks.
Number 85, Ramirez McKinney. And number 89,
hey, Brian.
Head coach, Josh.
Hey, man, we're about ready to go live with the pregame in just a minute here, so we're gonna get going, man. We're gonna hit record. We're gonna hit start recording, and we'll see what happens. Okay, you got it. Okay, Charlie, go ahead and hit record now. Oh, he's been recording for 5 minutes, so we're you got it. All right, thanks. Talk to you after the game. See you, buddy. Bye-bye. Hello and welcome everybody to Friday Night Football on Play On Sports. It's playonsports.com pregame show live from Bessemer, Alabama, where tonight we're going to have the Bessemer Academy Rebels against the
Big Vols. The Vols are coming in off of Monroe Academy.
They've made
the trip over and they're ready. They're fired up tonight.
That's right. That's right. And the voice you hear in the background, that's my partner, David Sauls, and I'm Steve Hall, and I'll be bringing you all the plays tonight. We'll be here all night, giving the action the live here from Bessemer. They come in tonight. So far this year, Bessemer's had a rough year. They started off with a 1-3 record, and that's something a little odd for this school, as they've won several AISA state championships. And the Vols come in, they're looking to stay undefeated. David, they've started out the year a house of fire. They've started off 3-0.
Well, you know, a lot of that goes to that big tailback they've got. They've got a guy in Craig Bryan, number 30. You're going to see him tonight for the Vols. He's a running back and a nose guard. This kid's coming in at a 6 flat even, and he's 255, and he brings a load out of that backfield.
Wow, quite the bowling ball there. I look forward to seeing that. What's Bessemer going to do to try to stop that this evening?
Yeah, Bessemer's got to put a lot of hats on him. That's the only way to get the big fella down. They've got to come low. Pad level wins this thing tonight. So who's ever got the lowest pad level? You know, they say the bigger they are, the harder they fall.
That's true. How about Bessemer on the offensive side of the ball? What are they trying to do tonight?
Well, Bessemer's got their strength is going to be the senior leadership they get out of that offensive line. Their offensive center, he's a senior. You know, a 40-man roster, they've got 14 seniors on it tonight.
Wow.
And for them to take on the Vols tonight, that senior leadership is going to have to come to the forefront.
Absolutely. Now, Monroe has made the long road trip today up here. When you were out on the field earlier with them, they seemed like they got their heads on straight. They're ready to play ball.
They sure do. Coach did a good job. He got them here early, and they had Hunter Glass out there. He's one of their seniors. He plays wide receiver and outside linebacker. They got off the bus in plenty of time. They've stretched out. They've walked the field. They're ready to go.
Well, as I mentioned earlier, we know Bessemer Academy is no stranger to big games. They've got a rich history of football. They've got 5 AISA state championships. Like I said, you know, last week, They had a tough loss to Lee Scott, which everybody who's into AISA knows that name. They're a perennial power, but they were able to take down Bessemer Academy last week, 33-7. These two teams have met 11 times, and as you can see, David, it's a pretty close battle here with Monroe having a slight edge at 6-5.
Yeah, and that's a great point you bring up. You're absolutely right. Between these two small schools, you've got 12 state titles out here tonight. So they're going to go head-to-head, and they're going to play till the whistle ends it at the end of the game. You better believe that.
Absolutely. Last year when these two teams met, they actually met twice last year, David. They met once in the regular season here in Bessemer, where the homestanding Rebels were able to take the game 28-9. And then in the playoffs, Bessemer was able to get them again 21-14 to beat a team 3 times in a row is really a tough feat.
It's a really tough feat, Steve. You bring that up. I mean, how many times do you see that at the next level or at the NFL when teams have to face up again? It's hard to do that that back-to-back-to-back win like that.
Absolutely, and I'm sure even with all that said, I know a lot of these guys that are on the field tonight were probably just youngsters, but, you know, these two have met for a state title on the line before back in 2001. Monroe was able to come out 33-13 on the good side in that one. So I think Bessemer's definitely got some things that they want to prove tonight.
Absolutely. And, you know, the good thing about these schools, knowing each other and playing each other, that means they're going to be ready to go.
Absolutely. And we're just about 10 minutes away here from kickoff here in Bessemer, and we're going to be coming up with your national anthem, and then we'll get the captains out on the field, and we'll be ready to go. So stay tuned here on playonsports.com. We'll be back in just a few minutes. And remember, Friday Night Football begins next with your destination for high school sports, playonsports.com. All right, folks, welcome back to Friday Night Football on PlayOnSports.com. Coming to you live from Bessemer, Alabama, I'm Steve Hall with David Sauls on your destination for high school sports, PlayOnSports.com. Tonight's matchup features the 1-3 homestanding Bessemer Academy Rebels against the visiting Monroe Academy Volunteers, who bring in a perfect record of 3-0. Looks like we're in for a good game tonight, David.
We sure do. They just had the toss. The Vols won the toss, and they've deferred to the second half.
I see that out there, and they've got their captains out there, and the captains for tonight for the Vols are going to be number 75, Cameron Bratcher, number 58, Malcolm Hughes, and number 28, which I don't have on our roster. I apologize for that.
It looks like he's got his number to 22, Brandon McKinley.
Okay, Brandon McKinley. There it is. Thanks, David. And over there on the Bessemer side of the ball tonight, we've got number 22, Chris Edwards, number 58, Everett Curry, number 77, Tyler Scarzaro, and number 62, Chase Smith. And we're just about 2 minutes away from kickoff. I can see the teams are both starting to line up in their respective end zones, David. We're getting ready to play some football.
Yeah, and you can feel it in the air tonight. It's a beautiful night here in Bessemer. I can tell you it's perfect football weather.
Well, I can tell you this. It sure is perfect in this air-conditioned press box where we are tonight.
That's right.
I can tell you that. There's no humidity. There's no moisture. There's no bugs. It's a perfect night. I'm not so sure that our cameraman, Charlie, who's on the outside, would say the same, but Charlie's out there bringing you all the video tonight, and Mark's working for us. He's producing the show, so we're excited to be here with you, and we look forward to a great night of football.
We sure do. Hey, back to those captains, Tyler Scarzaro for Bessemer Academy. He's a good-looking kid, 6'3", 285 pounds. He's going to run a little bit of left tackle for us tonight. He's going to play DN, and that's another one of those seniors that's going to have a big night tonight.
Yeah, you mentioned that. Coach Josh Wright was telling us in his pregame talk that's one of those guys that he's looking at to be a big producer. And then over on the other side, Coach Tuberville, he's got a couple weapons of his own, I believe, doesn't he, David?
He sure does. We talked about it earlier. Craig Bryan, his big back he's going to bring out of there, the big ramrine rod, 6 foot, 255 pounds. We're going to call his name a lot tonight.
So that's one we should look for tonight, huh?
Absolutely.
Fantastic. Well, we're just about get ready kickoff, folks. We're about a minute away for kickoff. As I said, we've already had the toss. We've said our prayers. We've done our national anthem. Only thing left to do is go play football, David.
That's right. You know, that's what these young men look for. They practice all week to come out here and do this. One of the things you'll often hear coaches say is they practice too, right? So they're practicing on both sides of this field tonight, and they're getting ready to take care of business.
Absolutely, and from what I understand, talking with Coach Wright and Coach Tuberville, I believe they both had a great week of practice leading up to this game. I think they both are right where they want to be right now.
Sure sounds like it. Sounds like Jonathan Wright, the offensive line and strength conditioning coach for Bessemer, he's confident in these young men. He's confident that he's taught them technique and he's got them where they need to be tonight.
Yeah, he was down on the field earlier. I was down there with you, and it looks like, okay, the players are coming out on the field. We're getting ready to tee this thing up. Getting ready to kick off for the Volunteers is going to be number 30, Craig Bryan, and there's that name already. My partner was on it, folks. He's not the best in the business for nothing. He told you we're going to call his name a lot tonight. It's a first name out of the chute.
Yeah, you got to love high school football, Steve. A young man can play nose guard, running back, and he can also be the kicker.
You got to love it. And back to receive for Bessemer, you've got number 7, Elijah Moore. He's a 10th grader. And then you've also got number 2, Jeremy Lacey, who's a junior. And here's the kick. The man has got a leg.
Oh, my word.
He kicks it out of the end zone,
He
folks.
Boomed it out of the back. He was about 5 yards shy of putting it through the upright, Steve.
He sure was. Craig Bryan with a nice kickoff there to start the game. So that's going to give the Rebels the ball first and 10 from their 20-yard line to open up the first quarter here tonight.
Noah Napier bringing in the call from the sideline. He's getting ready to go.
The Rebels are up to the line. Looks like Noah's going to be in the shotgun with a single back to the right. There's the snap. It's a quarterback keeper around the right side. He cuts it up. He gains about 6 yards on the play. Nice run by Napier there.
You got to love it. Colt Carroll come up from that, from his free safety spot. He come up and put the hit to stop it. But a nice little bunch package over there to the right, Steve. They bunched three little trips over here to the right, and they brought Noah right up in behind that.
Yeah, and they're going straight to the Rickspan. Looks like we've got a quick call. He's going to be in the split back out of the shotgun right now. Napier is, and there's the snap, and it's a quick inside handoff. That's number 22. That is Chris Edwards, and he's around the left side, and he picks up nice yardage, enough for a first down. But hang on just a second. I think we've got some laundry on the field there, David.
We sure do. That left side on that tall sweep coming out there, though, that's exactly what we were talking about. Those big guys, Tyler Scazzaro, he's getting right out there.
And there it is. It's a block in the back on the Rebels, so that's going to negate that first down run by Chris Edwards, and that's going to back the Rebels up, and it's going to give them second and probably about 10 again.
Yeah, Steve, how much of that you think is just, you know, jitters as this thing starts off? You know, we're just a couple of seconds ticking off here.
Sure, it's a chess match in the beginning. They're just trying to figure each other out and see what where those weaknesses on each side of the ball are. Napier's back under the in gun, and now it's a quick handoff to the right side. This time it's number two, Jeremy Lacy. He's still on his feet dancing. He picks up a few yards. It's going to bring up third down.
Hey, you got to like how Watson Kennedy, number 55 for the Vols, how he worked that inside out motion, because that was a nice cut by the back from Bessemer. He nice cut on a dime there, and number 55 worked it from the inside out just like he's supposed to do.
Sure did, and also got some help back there from Peyton Powell. The strong safety was up to help clean that up. It's going to bring up third and about two from the Rebels from the 28-yard line. He's under center this time, and it's a quarterback keeper. He's off the left side. He's sliding. It's going to be close, David. I think he's going to be a little short. I know we're at an odd angle here, but I think he's going to live a little bit short, and I think it's going to bring up fourth down.
They're going to call for it.
Yeah.
He calls it first down.
And there it is. The referee says it's good enough for him. That's a first down for the Rebels. Nice job there keeping his legs going by Napier to pick up that first down, because there really wasn't a hole there. Nice job on the left side of the line.
Yeah, I agree with you, Steve. There was no room there. He had to fight for every little inch he got there.
Napier's back with a single back to the left in the gun. There's your snap, and it's a straight lead to the left, but it's going nowhere. That was blown up by the defensive end. Was that number 61, Joe Watson, I think?
I think they brought in their corner. It looked like Colt Carroll, their inside linebacker, came down. They put him on the other side of the line, and he just crashed it. He came in unblocked.
He did. There was nothing there, and the play is going to lose. That play is going to lose about 5 yards, so it's going to bring up second and 15 here as we're just a couple of minutes into the first quarter. Napier takes the shotgun snap. He's going to throw this time. He hits number 15 on a quick slant. That's Matt Kiker, and he's going to get back to about the original line of scrimmage to make up that penalty, so they're going to be looking at third and about 10 there.
Yeah, absolutely, Steve. You got to wonder, though, that little quick thing like that, boy, that's a little scary on a Friday night, because I tell you, old double deuce, Brandon McKinley, he was up there. He was trying to sniff that thing out. He just didn't quite break on it quick enough.
Yeah, but he was there to meet him as soon as he caught the ball. He didn't get a lot of the yak that they like to talk about, the yards after catch. There wasn't a lot there. Napier takes a snap out of the gun. He's being pressured by that man, number 30. He tries to throw the out to number 15. He was looking for Kiker again, but this time it falls short. And there's that man you were talking about, number 30, Craig Bryan, right up the middle out of that nose guard position, David.
Yeah, he slipped his blocker, and he was in there putting in that big pressure. Big number 75 was in there too, Cameron Bratcher. He's one of their juniors, 6'3", 295. He's helping plug and take some big space in there.
Now, Noah Napier, the quarterback, he's going to stay in the game, but they're not going for it, folks. This is going to be – he's also your punter tonight. So Noah's going to be punting. It's going to be fourth and seven. He's going to be punting from around his own 20-yard line when he lets it go. And there's the kick. It's a nice kick, and it's caught right there at the 30-yard line by number one, Hunter Glass. He's still on his feet, and he gets about 5 yards, and that's about it before he's brought down there by number seven, Elijah Moore. So we got about a 40-yard punt there, maybe five on the return, and that's how the Volunteers are going to set it up. They're going to have it first and 10 from their own 35. When we come back, there's 8:41 to go in the first quarter. It's still scoreless. folks, here we're back. The Volunteers are on the field. Their quarterback number four, Jake McKenzie, is under center, and he takes a quick handoff right up the middle there. And I'm trying to get you a number who was carrying the ball there. That looks to be number 11. If I'm not mistaken, David, that was number 11, Justin Rowell. He's a 5'10 junior.
Yeah, you got to love that. They're taking their reads from their coach on the sideline there, and that's just that little belly. They want to see how soft the middle of that defense is for the Rebels.
And they picked up 5 yards. It's going to bring up second down and five. McKenzie's in the gun again with a single back to the left. And he's going to ride number 11 right up in that same hole again. There it is, Justin Rowell. He's already getting plenty of work. He's going to pick up a couple of more. It's going to bring up third and about, we'll call it a short four from the 42-yard line.
You can absolutely see that chess match. You can see Josh Wright bringing his corner in off the side, trying to stop some of that and pinch down.
Yeah,
just
that was
couldn't
Chris
get there.
Edwards trying to sneak in there. It looked like he was showing a little blitz. Now we're in the single back to the right. We're still in the shotgun for McKenzie. Takes the snap, hands it to number 11. He goes to the left. He cuts back. He's got daylight, folks. He's at the 30. He's at the 20, the 10. He is gone. Touchdown. That's number 11, Justin Rowell. He takes it to the house on a nice 58-yard touchdown run off the left side. So right off the bat with 7:27 to go in the first quarter, Monroe takes the early lead. They're up 6-0. And number 30, Craig Bryan, is in to attempt the extra point, David.
Absolutely, and he came out of the flanker position on that play. They lined him up to the left side of the offensive line in the flanker position, and he threw the kickout block to spring Rowell.
There was a nice hole there to the left side. They really contained the right end over there. And there's our man, number 30, Bryan, with that strong leg of his. No problem on that extra point right through the middle. And it was right down the middle, David. So with 7:27 to go in the first quarter, we've got a score on the board. It's now Monroe Academy 7, Bessemer Academy 0.
Do you want to watch more of your high school's great matchups like the game you're enjoying here tonight? Tell your school to sign up for the Play On Sports School Broadcast Program. The program allows schools to broadcast all their games and other activities on the web. For more information, go to playonsports.com/SBP.
All right, David, so we're back. We're getting ready for the kickoff. There's the man, number 30, Craig Bryan. He's marking it off. He's got it set up on the 40-yard line. Back deep for Bessemer, those same two return men, number 2, Jeremy Lacey, and number 7, Elijah Moore. And here's Bryan's kick. It's another boomer, David. And this time, I think he might have got it through the uprights this time, David. Of course, there's no score for that, folks, but it's nice to always see. So once again, Bryan does his job and pins the Rebels back. They're going to start 1st and 10 again from their own 20-yard line.
Well, when you consider that 70 yards, he just kicked it off the tee through the uprights. That's pretty impressive, wouldn't you say?
I would say so, especially for, what is that? What is he, an 11th grader, if I'm not mistaken?
No, he's their big senior.
Oh, he's a big senior. He's the leader on this team. That's right. All right, Napier breaks the Rebels from the huddle. He's in the shotgun. He's got a split backfield back there with him. Uh-oh. Looks like Bessemer, David, may have broke the huddle with 12 men. We may have a flag on the play.
Yeah, we definitely got one from our side judge over here. We're in a rough spot. It's hard to see where we're at, but it looks like there's some laundry over here. They're talking it out. Let's see what happens. Yep, they're going to call him for it.
That's what they've got, a legal substitution, which is the same thing as breaking the huddle with 12 men. So that's going to back the Rebels up 5. So far tonight, that's a couple penalties on them, David, and I know that's not going to make Coach Wright real happy right now.
No, sure not. You definitely want to see discipline out of your team.
And Napier under the gun again. He takes the snap. He's throwing that out again. He finds his man. That's his big man out there, number 18. That's Rodriguez McKinney. He's a 6'3 tight end. He's a senior for this team. He might have got the penalty yards back, David. Actually, he's going to pick up maybe 4, so we'll call it 2nd and 11 here from the 19-yard line.
That little out pattern, they're definitely executing it right now, but I can tell you Brandon McKinley is just waiting to sniff that thing out.
He's getting closer and closer. Napier takes a look at his wristband for the play, wipes his hands on the towel. There's the snap. It's the inside handoff. I couldn't see who that was real quick because he was so covered up by that big man, the nose guard, number 75, Cameron Bratcher. gobbled him up real quick, and play picked up maybe 2 yards. We're kind of call it third and eight here from the 22-yard line.
You got to like the misdirection, though, Steve. Coach Josh Wright trying to throw a little counter in there to keep that defensive line that's pouring through. He's trying to keep them honest.
He sure is, and I'll tell you what, right now that defensive front's really getting some pressure on the ball, so it's going to bring third down. Got two wideouts to the left for Bessemer and a single back shotgun. Napier takes the snap. He drops back the throw. He's looking on the right side. He's looking for number 21, Josh Bowles, but it falls incomplete. Back there defending was number 24, Connor Morgan, the cornerback. So it's going to bring up fourth down for the Rebels, and Napier's going to have to punt again.
I tell you, this Hunter Glass is dangerous. They had a great coverage on him last time, but Hunter, he shook the first tackler, but the Bessemer Rebels, they kind of swarmed him right after that.
And this one's going to be Napier this time is going to be punting from about his own 10-yard line. He takes the snap, and there's the punt. It's a nice kick. Glass catches it on the fly at the 42-yard line, and he goes nowhere, folks. He's met instantly by number two, Jeremy Lacey, the junior wide receiver and free safety, was down there on the coverage, and there was no gain on the punt, so it's going to give Monroe first and 10 from their own 40-yard line, and we've got 5:51 to go in the first quarter with Monroe still leading 7-0.
You got to love that, Steve. That's what you want. You want a free safety with the little wheels, and he showed his wheels getting down there to cover that punt.
Well, he also brought something with him when he got down there. That was a nice lick that he was able to make on the play there. So Jake McKenzie is in the backfield taking the snap. There's Justin Lowry, the fake to him. McKenzie takes it straight up the gut on a quarterback keeper. Nice little tough run in there by the quarterback. Picks up about 6 or 7 yards. Looks like he was brought down there by number 62, Chase Smith, for the Rebels, but not before he picks up 7 yards.
Yeah, you got to love that. That defense in the middle, I tell you, the coach for the Volunteers, he's going to keep trying that. That's his game plan tonight. He wants to see what that middle feels like.
Yeah, he's testing it out early, and McKenzie's back in the single back shotgun again, and they're going right up the gut, right at him again. But this time, they're ready for it this time. That was number 22, Chris Edwards. He gobbles it up. The play might have actually lost a yard. On the carry there was number 11, Justin Rowell, but this time they were able to sniff that one out, David.
Yeah, he really came off of that right end, just like he had done earlier tonight. He just pinched down on it. That's what you want to see out of a linebacker or a DN. You want him to have that kind of pinch down ability.
And McKenzie's in the shotgun yet again. McKenzie's going to keep it on a quarterback keeper. Looked like they might have had a little option play there. David, he was trying to find number 11, Justin Rowell, but nice job there by the Rebels corner to sniff that out and make the quarterback keep it, and it's going to bring up fourth down for the Volunteers.
Yeah, you got to love that. That's fundamental football right there. The cornerback stretched it out, and that allowed 58 Everett Currier to come off from the other side of the D-line and make that play. That's good, solid football.
And so it looks like the Volunteers thought about it for a minute, but since they're just shy of midfield, they are going to punt. And back to punt is the man with the leg, number 30, Craig Bryan. We've seen his kickoff ability and his extra points. Let's see what he's got for a punt. Back to receive for the Rebels. This is unique. They've got two back to receive. They've got number two.
They blocked it. They blocked it. They got a block on it.
Bessemer's blocked the kick. And it's recovered right there by number 44, Shannon Edwards. He recovers it.
Jeremy Lacey came in unguarded. They tried to put a little hat on him, and Jeremy Lacey is having none of it tonight. He shed his blocker and got in there and got two hands on the ball.
And Shannon Edwards was right there to gobble it up. It's going to give the Rebels their best field position of the night, David, no doubt about it. They're going to have the ball well inside Volunteer territory. They're going to set up camp. Looks like it's going to be about the 33-yard line of the Volunteers, and we've got a timeout on the field. So at 3:51 to go in the first quarter, your score is Monroe Academy 7, Bessemer Academy 0.
One match away from immortality.
This is a total team effort.
We're going to try to dictate to you what you're going to do on both the offense and defense.
Magic! 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 the hats on and go get some work done.
So they're all going to look to make a statement early.
.16 left to go in this ball game.
Is the difference right now. But momentum is on Bessemer's side right now with that blocked punt.
Absolutely, absolutely, without a doubt. This is their best opportunity. They may be able to do some other things with their offense because they have been kind of hemmed back tonight thanks to the kickoff ability there of the Volunteers, number 30, Craig Bryan. He's pinned them deep every time. And he was actually the one back trying to make the punt as well that was blocked by Shannon Edwards.
Yeah, outstanding.
Shannon Edwards was the one who picked up the punt. I'm not giving my man Jeremy Lacey enough credit for laying out and getting that block off his foot there.
And the other thing, too, you think about, as you talk about Jeremy Lacey, he's already seen the power in Craig Bryan's leg already, and to still not be afraid to go out there and get it, that's a different thing. Hey, during that timeout, though, a unique thing that the Rebels did, the entire team was on the field during the timeout.
Yes, they sure were. They sure were, and now it looks like we've scouted back. We've got just the offensive side of the ball out there now. Coach Wright is talking to them. I'm sure they're discussing what they want to do, especially with this first play here. As we mentioned, it's a beautiful night here in Bessemer for football. These two AISAA powerhouses going head-to-head. As we mentioned, Monroe so far has really not been tested this year, David. They've looked strong in all their games. They're 3-0. Bessemer comes in at 1-3, and I know that's something that they're not accustomed to with their five state championships. This has got to be a little bit different for them.
Yeah, and you got to wonder how the team's prepared for that this week. Maybe Coach Wright used that as a little motivation. Hey, they come in here, they think they're better than we are. Let's show them. And on the other side of that, on the other side of the ball, you got to wonder how the Vols prepared their team to say, look, don't take these guys lightly. Don't look at their record and grade them on that. You got to grade what comes to the field on Friday night.
Absolutely, and I think, you know, with Coach Turberville knowing that he's got to come into their place and play, they've got to make the long drive from Monroeville, and it's going to be 4 or 5 hours on a bus. Nobody likes that, especially high school kids. There's a lot of distractions. You know, when back in the days when we were playing ball, though, David, there were no iPods and
That's right.
iPhones and all this stuff. We just had to talk, you know, so. So these kids should be well-rested. They look like they are, and they're ready to play. And Napier's leading the Rebels back out on the field after the timeout. And let's see what they've got going here. It's going to be 1st and 10 from the 38-yard line of the Vols. He's going to be in the shotgun with split backs. And there's the snap. He's going to give the inside handoff. That's that man number 22, Chris Edwards, and he's around left side. That's that quick hit we were looking for, David, and it gains nice yardage. But yet again, David, it looks like we've got a flag on the field.
We sure do, but that's another one of those explosive plays. You're absolutely right. Our double deuce, Chris Edwards, came off of that left side of that offensive line,
and there
he
it
made
is.
A cut.
It's a hold on Bessemer. They continue to shoot themselves in the foot on their drives with these holding procedure penalties. That's going to back them up 10 yards and put them close to midfield now.
Offensive coordinator Randy Thomas is down on the field, and he's talking to him. He's trying to get him in that right spot.
So now after the penalty, it's going to bring up 2nd down and 20 from the Volunteer 44-yard line for the Rebels. Correction, that's 1st down. We'll redo the down. Napier's going to stay in the shotgun with the split backs. He's still got Chris Edwards back there, along with Jeremy Lacey, I believe. And there's the quick pitch. It's a quick shot to Josh Bowles on the right side. It's that quick, I wouldn't even call it a slant. It's more of just a quick, here's the ball, and it's going to the outside on a quick hitch. And that was number 21, Josh Bowles, on the reception. He's a 5'10", 10th grader.
Yeah, they call that a little jailbreak pass. They throw it out there and let the receiver break out of jail, if he would.
He picks up about 7 yards on the play, so it's going to bring up second down and 13. There's the inside handoff to the right. There's Double Deuce. He's running again. That's Chris Edwards. He's fighting hard, but he's going to get back. Looks like he's brought down there by number 55, Watson Kennedy, the 175-pound junior for the Vols. And it's just going to get them back to the original line of scrimmage, so it's going to be third down and 10 for the Rebels on the volunteer 34-yard line.
And you got to love Colt Carroll coming from that inside linebacker spot. He came up. He put a lick down there.
Sure did. Napier obviously likes to work with the split backs out of the shotgun. We've got another back in there now. That's Drake St. John on the right, and he's going to get the handoff right up the gut. Looks like he's a tough runner. But he's cut down almost immediately there. That's number 20, Colt Carroll again. Colt Carroll keeps finding that middle, and he keeps stopping it up, and it's going to bring up fourth down for the Rebels. And, you know, David, from where they are, you're looking at about a 51, 52-yard field goal.
They're definitely going to go for it. They leave Noah on the field. Colt Carroll on that last stop, he's 5'9", and you talk about pad-level winning. He just showed it.
He brings it with him, that's for sure. And Napier's got him in the shotgun with the split back again on 4th and 7. He's going to drop back. There's that quick slant. He finds number 16, I believe. He looks for him over the middle. That was Matt Kiker right there. That's the third time he's found him tonight. Clearly his favorite receiver thus far. And that's enough for the Rebel first down, David.
It absolutely is. You can hear that crowd respond to it. They know it's a first down, and they know with a minute 47 here in the first quarter how important it is to come down here and put some points on the board.
That was definitely a gutsy call there. First big play of the night, really, for the Rebels. Let's see if this gets their offense going. Napier comes back. He's still in the shotgun with a split backfield. He takes the snap. It's the quick handoff to number 22. He goes around the right side. He gets positive yardage, but not a lot, before he's met there by Peyton Powell. But I'll tell you what, Chris Edwards is not a man who goes down with the first point of contact.
He sure didn't. He's not letting anybody arm tackle him. We got some laundry out there on the field. Let's see what the referee says. He's going to call a chop block on – he's going to bring a chop block on Bessemer, I believe.
Yes, it looks like that is what he's called. And from the looks of it up here, it doesn't look like Coach Wright agrees with him on that call.
No, sure doesn't.
Napier's talking to Coach Wright right now. They're on the sideline here. We've got a minute 24 to go, folks. And this it's been an action-packed first quarter. I know the scoreboard only reads 7-0, but we've had a lot happened in this first 11 minutes of football, David.
We sure have.
Napier after the penalty. It's going to bring up first and 20 for the Rebels. They're back to the 30. They're at the 29-yard line. And they've got three wide receivers, two to the right, one to the left, and a split backfield. Back in the back, you've got number 7, Elijah Moore, and number 25, Drake St. John, back there with Napier. Now it looks like the referees have realized that's a 15-yard penalty, and they're going to back them up 5 more. So it's going to bring up 1st and 25 from the Rebels from the 34. Napier drops back the pass. He's got good protection. He lets it fly deep down the sideline, and that is going to be intercepted. That's number 24, Connor Morgan, the 5'10 junior cornerback for the Volunteers, has picked it off, David.
Yeah, you got to love that. But, you know, let's keep it into perspective. You know, they were in a punt situation a couple of downs before. So, you know, will this hurt the Rebels as much as we might think? Maybe not. They got them backed up, and they might be able to capitalize on this interception.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that was that was our first turnover of the ball game, folks, with 1:12 to go in the first quarter. Now, it does have the Vols backed up deep. They've got the ball on their own 2-yard line here. And they're coming in the power eye. We've got a little bit of different format here this time, David.
Power eye. They're bringing that power eye behind Craig Bryan.
Straight handoff off the left lead, and that's number 11. That's Justin Rowell, and he takes it off the left tackle side. Picks up about 4 yards, going to bring up 2nd down and 6 for the Volunteers.
You got to love that. He was following the lead block of his place kicker. You don't get to say that too much.
No, you're right, David. You really don't. That's the great thing about high school football.
The clock is winding down here.
Sure is. They're back in the power eye again. Long snap. He takes it off and hands it to his deepest back, and he just dives right into the pile where he's met by a whole host of Rebels. And he, it looks like we've got an injury on the field, David.
We sure do. That was a quick call by the ref. Someone got a player holding his knee. I can't get a number for you right now. I want to say it's Matthew Williams, their big 6'7", 235-pound tackle, but I can't tell from here. Nope. It's definitely not him because Matthew's up and coming towards us.
Yeah, I can't. The training staff and the coaches are around him now. We've got a couple people going on the field. We'll see what we can find out for you, and we'll get right back to you. With 30 seconds to go here in the first quarter, Monroe Academy 7, Bessemer Academy 0.
One match away from immortality.
This is a total team effort.
We're going to try to dictate to you what you're going to do on both offense and defense.
Now it's time to put the hats on and go get some work done.
So they're all going to look to make a statement early.
Sixteen left to go,
and that's one of those things when you have those piles like that, David. You know, the guy on the bottom of the pile. There's a lot going on. There's people flying in and over the top and around. It's one of those what they call exactly what it is. It's just a football injury. You know,
that's right.
It's you know, one of those things that happens, and you hate to see it. And this young man's been playing hard all night tonight, and you know, he's a senior, and for a lot of these guys, especially where they're seniors, this might be their last opportunity to play on a football field and put the pads on. So you hate to see that at any time, but you really hate to see it for a senior. And so far, for a guy who was really playing well tonight so far.
Absolutely.
So now that he's made it to the sidelines, we're back and ready to play some football. It looks like the Rebels have replaced him with number one, Jalen Winston. And he's a 10th grader, so we'll see if that experience comes into play. The Volunteers taking the snap under shot. They're going to take it out of the shotgun. He's going to roll right. He's looking for his man. The ball is batted up into the air.
It's
and
an
it looks like it's – you're right, David. It has been intercepted. The old trip drill. And the man that came up with the ball there, that's number 58. That's Everett Curry, an 11th grader. He's a defensive end. Good-sized man. And you don't usually see them trailing the play and making a tip catch like that, David.
That's right. That's definitely exciting. You got to say, Jake McKenzie rolled out for the Vols, and it looked like a solid throw, and then there was just a play made.
Looked like I think he might have hit the receiver in the shoulder pad that caused that big carom there, David.
That's right.
And so the Rebels get the ball right back. So we've traded turnovers, and they got a little bit better field position. They're going to have it first and 10 from, we'll call it the 20-yard line. And it's a quarterback keeper. Napier keeps it himself. He's fighting around the right side.
Oh, you got to love that from your quarterback, Steve. He carried four players on that play.
Looks like he was met there by number 58, Malcolm Hughes, and number 75, Cameron Bratcher. But he was still able to fight forward for 4 yards, David. And that's going to bring us to the end of the first quarter. A lot of fireworks. It may not show it on the scoreboard, but we've got a lot going on here. At the end of the first quarter, it's Monroe Academy 7 and Bessemer Academy 0, but they've got the ball deep, deep inside Volunteer territory.
Absolutely, they're threatened. Play On Sports is on Facebook and Twitter, giving you news and information and links to great highlights. Follow us at Play On Sports on both Facebook and Twitter. You can also access thousands of live and on-demand games on YouTube. That's right, youtube.com/playonnetwork. Keep up with all the high school action every week. From your destination for high school sports, it's playonsports.com.
match away from immortality.
This is a total team effort.
We're going to try to dictate to you what you're going to do on both offense and defense.
It's time to put the hats on and go get some work done.
They're all going to look to make a statement early.
Folks, welcome back. We're getting ready to start the second quarter. And, David, that was an eventful first quarter. We had each team with a turnover. The Volunteers had a punt block, but they also had the huge 58-yard touchdown by Justin Rowell for our lone score. But Bessemer, here they are inside the 20, knocking on the door.
Absolutely. They're definitely threatening right now.
Oh, it's a double reverse, and Napier flips it back to number two. That's Jeremy Lacey, and he takes it around the left side. We're off in this corner again, folks. We're trying to give you the best shot we can. It's going to put the ball inside the 10-yard line, and it's going to give the Rebels enough for a first down, David.
A first down inside your 10-yard line. That's what you want to see.
Coach Wright going to his bag of tricks there with the double reverse and give him the ball first and goal.
Yeah, they're in a dangerous spot right now with the short side of the field closest to us. A lot of room on that wide side. Let's see if the Rebels are able to capitalize on the field position.
Napier again, he's in the shotgun with the split backs. There's the snap, and he's going to give that inside handoff.
Fumble. Fumble, Ruski.
There was a fumble on the play, and there's that turnover we were talking about. The Volunteers are able to get on it there, David. We're trying to see who that is there on the bottom. It looks like number two, Peyton Powell, picks up the ball, and he's gonna hold that lead right now for the Volunteers.
You got to love that. That's good sound football again by Monroe Academy, though. They came in, they put a hat on the helmet, and when that happens, it's hard to hold onto the pigskin.
They were quick in the backfield there, David. They almost took that handoff, and I think they were able to break up that exchange between the quarterback and running back there. So now back out on the field is Jake McKenzie, and he's under center. He's going to hand it off. Oh, he's going to drop back the pass. He's throwing the ball deep.
He got him.
And he looks like he got his man. He sure did. A nice 30-yard completion there. Trying to get you a number on that one. It's on the far side of the field. It was number 16. That was Caleb Smith. He's the 6'1 junior. He used every bit of that 6'1 frame to go up and get that nice out route thrown there by Jake McKenzie. Gets the Volunteers out from under their own goalpost there, David. It's going to give them first and 10 from the 32.
Definitely. Jeremy Lacey made a nice play on the ball. He just couldn't get there in time.
Oh, we got a flag on the play. It looks like the right tackle may have twitched a little bit there for the Volunteers, and that's what the call is.
And you know that happens sometimes. These young men, Steve, they start thinking about what they got to do, where their next step is, and sometimes they're trying to get to that step before anybody else can get there.
Yeah, if you've never put on the pads before, everybody thinks, how can you not know the snap count? But that's it happens to the guys who make those big, big checks every Sunday. They still do it as well. So McKenzie brings his troops back up. It's going to give him first and 15, and he's in the gun. He's got a single back next to him. He's dropping back the pass. He's got it up. He's throwing it deep. He's got a man out there. Oh! Diving outstretched hands of, I believe that was Peyton Powell, and it was. He was trying to hook up with him. Boy, I got to tell you, David, it's my first time seeing Jake McKenzie as a quarterback, but he's a nice-looking kid in the pocket, that's for sure.
Absolutely. He showed a lot of poise right there. He had some time to throw, too, though. He had the pocket around him. He stepped up and made the throw, deep throw down the middle. You got to like the way that Elijah Moore, number 7, tried to recover for Bessemer. He was out of position. He was able to use some speed and catch up, and he was there. He was there at the end of the play.
Yeah, they list McKenzie at 6'1", 185, but I got to tell you, he looks a lot bigger than that from up here, David.
He sure does.
He's got a split backfield with him back in that gun. There's that quick handoff. to number 11. Oh, he's jumping, folks. That was Justin Rowell, the man who had had the long touchdown. He picks up about 8 yards after he dives over a couple of Rebel linebackers. He's finally dropped there by number 2, Jeremy Lacey.
Yeah, Bailey Stevens came in to make that play. He came in low, and when you get low too quick, the coaches call it breaking down too fast. Broke down too fast, and Justin took advantage of it.
And that's going to bring up about a third and third and six for the Volunteers. They've got the ball on the their own 34-yard line. McKenzie's in the shotgun. He drops back. He's getting pressured. He's going to have to pull it down and throw it. And he does. He just throws it straight to the sideline, David. And I don't think that got back to the line of scrimmage. We could be looking at an intentional grounding call. He was being hounded there by big number 77, Tyler Scarzo. And that is the call. They're going to call intentional grounding, which is going to back them up, but it's also going to bring up fourth down.
Yeah, that's a loss of down kind of play. With 9:58 left to go here in the second quarter, that's the perfect kind of play you need to help kind of silence things down from that visiting team. Because I tell you, Big Orange, they're knocking right now.
They sure are, and Craig Morgan's going to be back to punt, but it's going to pin him deep. He's going to be catching this punt just shy of the goal line. And after having his last one blocked, I know he's going to be wanting to get this off quick. So let's see what the Rebels can bring. We've got number 3.
Looks like they let him kick it.
They
get it
safe. That's number 21. Josh Bowles picks up the punt, and he's going down the right side. Didn't have much blocking, but he is able to get across midfield. Nice return, about an 18-yard return. Also a nice punt by Brian.
Yeah, you got to love the way he Josh read the field position. Josh Bowles took that punt, and he realized that he had a lot of room on the wide side of the field. And you got to love the leadership of number 8, Noah Napier. He went right out there. Like Steve said, not a lot of blocking, but you got one little block out of your quarterback, and you got to love that.
Absolutely. You always like to see that quarterback blocking, but you don't want him using that throwing shoulder to do it.
That's for sure.
So Napier's going to huddle up the Rebels here. They're going to have it first and 10 at the Volunteer 46-yard line. They're still trailing. They're only down 7-0 with, and they've turned the ball over twice. So they're not in bad shape here. They're looking to get something going on this drive. Napier's in the shotgun again with a split backfield. He's got two wideouts to the left and one to the right.
We got a small delay. The referees, we've got some headlights shining into the players' eyes. So we got a ref over there trying to get a car out of the parking lot.
Well, I tell you what, refs have to do it all.
They got
to
do it all. They sure do.
They're babysitters, parking attendants, they do it all. Napier's ready to take the snap now. And there it is. He's in the gun. It's a quick handoff to number 25 around the left side. That's Drake St. John. He's had a couple nice carries tonight. You can tell, boy, he's a nice fullback. He stays low and hard. He was finally tripped up. I think that was number 24 out there, Connor Morgan, the corner that was able to chop him down, but not before he picked up about 5 yards on the play.
Yeah, they found one way to get Drake off the field. They took his shoe off of him, so he's off on the sideline right now putting his shoe back on.
Well, there's more than one way to stop him, that's for sure. So Napier, they're still in the split back. Now we've got two wideouts to the right, one to the left. There's the snap. It's a quarterback keeper with an option pitch, and he does pitch it. He pitches it to number 7, Elijah Moore, and he squirms down the left side. He's finally knocked out of bounds there by number 30, Craig Bryan, but he's going to be awfully close to another Rebel first down.
Yeah, Steve, just an injury update on 22, Chris Edwards. They're down working on him on the sideline. He's definitely done for the evening. They've already started wrapping him up and icing him down, and you can see the pain on the young man's face.
Yeah, we can definitely see that from where we are. That's for sure. We wish him all the best. Napier's in the gun with his split backs again. Whoop, they didn't get this one off. I think we might have a procedure call against the Rebels. And as you were mentioning, Chris Edwards, we wanted to wish him the well. Hope everything goes well. Don't see any EMT folks down there with him, so we hope that that's a good sign. Nothing maybe that, maybe a bump or a bruise or something, but we'll have to wait and see. We'll see if we can't get you some more information as the game goes along. And that's what it was. It was a procedure call, David. And that now instead of a third and a short one, they're going to have a third and 6 for the Rebels from their own 41-yard line with 8:18 to go here in the half. And they've got it spread again, two to the right and one to the left. With a split backfield. Handoff to number 7, Elijah Moore, and he is sunk down in the backfield. There's that man. You've heard my partner David call his name several times tonight. That's number 20, Colt Carroll, on the play.
And you got to love the chess match that's happened with Coach Tuberville. Steve was showing you how they're getting these nice little runs, these nice little counters. He brought them to the line in a 6-2 defense that time. He really crowded the line, and that allowed inside linebacker Colt Carroll to run free. When he got free, he made the play.
And that's gonna lose about 5 yards, so it's going to bring up 4th and 10 after they just had a 3rd and less than 1. So that's got to be discouraging for the Rebels. But it's going to bring up 4th down. Napier's going to be punting the ball from about his own 40-yard line. He's going to be punting it back deep back to receive. Back there is Hunter Glass again. And it's a low-line kick, but it's got some nice roll to it, and it's angling towards the sideline. And it's going to go out of bounds inside the 20-yard line, and they keep walking. Looks like they're going to mark it just about the 13-yard line, David. So the Rebels have done a good job pinning the Volunteers deep. They're going to be 1st and 10 from their own 13.
Got to love that. I love that when that happens to me on the golf course, when I hit a ball and it bounces down like that. So Noah breaking out his 8-iron.
The old worm burner.
That's right.
Absolutely. And the Volunteers are wasting no time. They come straight out, no huddle. They're ready to go. Jake McKenzie brings him to the line. He's also in the shotgun with this spread backs, and then two wideouts to the left, one to the right. They're both running roughly the same kind of offense here. Quick handoff to Rowell on the left side. He goes right off left tackle. He's still moving his feet. Nice leverage out of the pile there. There really wasn't much there, David, but he kept his feet moving and actually wound up picking up about 4 yards on the play.
And you got to love their big 6'7" Matthew Williams. He plays offensive tackle, and he's playing D-line right now. He actually stayed low and kept that pile right there in the middle for the Rebels.
Absolutely. Great job with leverage there. And, you know, David, it looks like they run similar offenses, so both of the defenses should be used to seeing this offense every day in practice. So I think that's why we're seeing the low-scoring ball game that we have.
Yeah, that's a great observation.
McKenzie's in the single back shotgun. It's a quick handoff to Rowell again on the left side. He cuts it back up into the teeth of the defense there. But he picks up about 6 yards. And actually, he picked up about 7 yards. And they're going to say Rowell got enough for a Volunteer first down.
Yeah, and they're going to keep the pressure on. They're getting the reads from the sideline right now. 6:21 to go before the half.
McKenzie back in the single back. He's in the shotgun. He brings the Volunteers to the line, and there's the snap. It's a quick handoff to number 11, Rowell. On that boy, they keep pounding the left side of the line there, and they keep getting positive yardage. He's going to pick up about 3. For Rowell, that left side of the Volunteer line is really firing off.
Yeah, and we got big 77, Tyler Scazzaro. He's coming up a little bit limp over there on that right side of the Rebel defense.
Well, that could be something they're noticing, because they keep wanting to go work their left side, the Bessemer right side, back in the single back shotgun again. This time it looks like it's going to be a quick pass. He throws it off his back foot. He was looking for his man, number 1, Hunter Glass, over the middle. But number 1 for the Rebels was there. Jalen Winston right in his face, giving pressure to McKenzie, so he had to throw off his back foot and kind of short-armed it a bit, and it falls incomplete, and it's going to bring up 3rd and about 6 for the Volunteers from their own 30-yard line with 5:25 to go here in the first half.
Yeah, you got to love that, Steve. You're calling Jalen Winston's number. That's the sophomore that came in for Chris Edwards, so the young sophomore making a presence felt here early in the first half.
Absolutely, doing a nice job filling in for the injured Edwards. There's the quick handoff to Rowell. Oh, and some misdirection to number 18, Ethan Nall, and they caught the Rebels sleeping there. What a nice call there by the Volunteers, David.
Absolutely. It was a little reverse, actually. The misdirection counter out of the backfield. The back got it. He gave it to the receiver coming around to the left side of the field and picked up a nice gain.
Picked up about 18 yards on the play, and it's going to bring up 1st and 10 for the Volunteers on their own 45-yard line, and they're ready to go. They've got their foot on the gas. They're running this quick NASCAR-type offense that you see. A lot of spread action. Got a two-back spread, and he's dropping. McKenzie rolls out to his right looking for his man, He was looking for number two, Peyton Powell, out of the backfield. Just a little high, but, of course, he was blanketed there in coverage by number 62, linebacker Chase Smith by the Rebels.
You got to like that. See the linebacker drop down kind of like a Pittsburgh Steelers-type zone blitz. They came up with that 4-4 defense, and then all of a sudden it turned into a 4-3 really quick. Chase made that big drop.
Sure did. He opened those hips quick and dropped back and got into the passing lanes. And McKenzie's back up to the line, ready to go again. We're in the shotgun. We've got wide outs on either side and a single back in the shotgun. And there it is, the quick handoff to number 11. That's Justin Rowell on the right side. He tries to cut it back up. But there's that man again, number 62, Chase Smith. Having quite a ball game on the defensive side of the ball for the Rebels. Picks up really no yardage, maybe a yard. It's going to bring up third and nine.
And Noah Napier coming out of that strong safety spot, coming up to provide some run support. With them running like this, we're going to have to get some run support out of that defensive backfield in there. They came up and stuck a helmet on them that time.
Absolutely. The Volunteers come to the line. They've got wide outs on they got split on the left and a single on the right with a single backfield. And here comes the shotgun. He rolls out. He's looking. He can't find anybody. He's got to throw it away. Boy, he was being chased there by number 18, Rodriguez McKinney, the big 6'3", 240-pound defensive end, was breathing down his neck that time, David.
Absolutely. And you got to give a little bit of that to the coverage for the defensive backs of the Rebels. They were blanketed. Jake had nowhere to go with that ball.
Absolutely, and so that's going to force the Volunteers to punt. Number 30, Craig Bryan, is back to punt. Back deep to receive for the Rebels is number 21, Josh Bowles. And we saw on the last punt, if it gets near him, he knows what to do with it. He's headed north.
Sure does, and he's a young man, only a sophomore.
And there's the kick. Morgan kicks a booming kick. It's caught by Bowles. He's fumbled it just for a second at the 15. He picks it up and takes off up the left side. He's still on his feet. Nice 15-yard return by Bowles before he's brought down there by number 18, Ethan Nall, and number 55, Watson Kennedy, for the Volunteers.
And a nice kick-out block by number 44, Shannon Edwards. Don't know if there's any relation to Chris Edwards, but big 44 came in and had a nice kick-out block. He really took it to Peyton Powell on that play.
And, David, I hope this isn't more bad news for the Rebels. I see number one. Jalen Winston limping along the sidelines. He's the sophomore we told you just came in to replace the injured Chris Edwards. He looks to be in pain. He's just taking his helmet off. We'll try to see if we can get some more information for you on that. We've got the trainers are checking him out now. We've got a timeout on the field, and with 3:31 to go in the half, the Volunteers have just punted the ball away to the Rebels, and they're going to have it first down and 10 from their own 30-yard line when we come back.
PlayOnSports.com is not only your destination for Friday night football action, but it's also the place for the most comprehensive coverage of high school playoff and championship events in all sports from across the country. PlayOnSports.com, high school sports lives here.
One match away from immortality.
This is a total team effort.
We're going to try to dictate to you what you're going to do on both the offense and defense. We're going to come at you.
One shot.
Now it's time to put the hats on and go get some work done.
They're all going to look to make a statement early.
.16 left to go.
You look at these stats and you see You see a blocked punt and three turnovers, and you think, wow, we got some sloppy football. But I got to be honest with you, these plays that are being made, they're good plays. They're not miscues at all.
Absolutely. It's not been breakdowns. It's been young men making good plays on the ball.
Absolutely. And Bessemer is really hadn't had a lot to speak of on offense. They're trying a couple of different things. They've had a couple of big plays, but that Volunteer front four has really been putting the pressure on the Rebels.
And that's a great call. And even the adjustments that we've seen the Volunteers make, you know, when Bessemer started having success running some of those counters and running some of that stuff across the middle and coming out on the corner, well, the Volunteers made the adjustment to go to that 6-2 and kind of settle those things down. Really interested in the timeout techniques for Bessemer Academy. They bring the entire team out onto the field. We've got, again here, we got 42 players on the field for a timeout.
Wow. And I got to say, these timeouts seem a little longer than normal as well, David. I think those are those mandated state of Alabama heat advisory water breaks, if I'm not mistaken.
Absolutely. They're trying to take care of the athletes, and that's what we all want. Coaches want that. Fans want it. You know, the fans are also parents. You know, you want to take care of the young men.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You bring up a great point, David. I think a lot of people tend to forget these are all these fine young men who are out here on this field tonight. These are all somebody's children, and that's exactly what they are. They're just young men, and you know, they get on all these pads, and they're all of a sudden they're 6'4", 240. We forget that they're just kids, you know. So we have to do what we have to do to protect them. But it looks like the refreshment break is over, as we say, and the Rebels are coming to the line, and they're going to have it first and 10 from their 30-yard line. Napier's in the shotgun with his split back, and they've got two wideouts to the right and a single wideout to the left. Quick handoff there to number 7, Elijah Moore. He tries to get to the outside. He picks up about 5 yards before he's slung down there by that was number 20, I believe. That was number 20, Colt Carroll, and also in on the play was number 4, Jake McKenzie.
That's right. Jake's out playing strong safety right now. He's actually free safety in the middle of the field, and Jake came up with a little run support there.
Absolutely, and Colt Carroll's having a phenomenal game at linebacker for the Volunteers. Second down, quick handoff. They're going to try the left side this time to the bigger back, Drake St. John, number 25. He puts his head down, gets a couple of tough yards. Looks like he was cut down there by number 65, Trey Carter. It's going to bring up 3rd and 4 for the Rebels.
Yeah, Watson Kennedy came in from his outside linebacker spot to help provide a little support on that as well.
Napier's got two wideouts to the right and one to the left and two backs back there with him in a split backfield. There's the snap. He's looking for that quick out again, and he's got his man. That's number 83, but he was hit immediately by number 24, Connor Morgan, causes him to drop the ball, and it falls incomplete. I got to tell you, if it's not for Connor Morgan, that's a first down for the Rebels, David.
Absolutely, and you got to love the way Connor Morgan broke on the ball. He didn't play the ball that time. He played the receiver, played right where he needed to be, and he delivered a hit that separated the ball from the receiver.
Absolutely. Now, Noah Napier is going to be back to punt, and he's punting to that man, Hunter Glass, for the Volunteers. He's standing back about his 25-yard line. And we've got just over 2 minutes to go here in the first half. There's Napier's punt. It's a spinning line drive, and Glass is going to pick it up on a hop. And, whoa, he didn't have anywhere to go. Right there to meet him instantly was number 2, Jeremy Lacey, and he might have even knocked him back a couple of yards. And that's where the Volunteers, they're going to take over 1st and 10 from their own 20-yard line with a minute 56 to go in the half and leading the ball game 7-0. And if I had to bet, I bet Coach Tuberville is going to have his foot on the gas right here, David. I expect them to come down the field fairly quick.
Yeah, you got to think they're going to take their shots right now with just a minute 56 left to go in the half. I got to tell you, Steve, what do you think about the special teams play of old number 2, Jeremy Lacey? I mean, he's been all over the field tonight.
He has. He's blocking punts. He's tackling returners for losses. He's really had a nice job on special teams. Now Jake McKenzie brings his group to the line with a – he's got double wide out to the left and to the right with a single back, and it looks like he's trying to go deep. He pumps once to the right, then comes back left, and he's got a man wide open, David.
He's
he
gone.
Is streaking down the sidelines. That's Hunter Glass, and he is in for the touchdown.
Can you say Steve called that from here? He said they're going to put their foot on the gas, and Coach Tuberville comes straight out with just a go route down the left side of the field.
Well, I got to tell you, that play was all made possible. Don't get me wrong. Hunter Glass did a great job on the reception and carrying it into the house there. But I got to tell you, what an unbelievable fake pump fake there by Jake McKenzie to able to draw that safety. He fake pumped to the right and drew the safety to the left side of the field, and that's where he found his man Hunter Glass on the other side, wide open, single coverage on a corner with no help from the safety. Great play. And there's the kick for the extra point, number 30, Craig Bryan, and he bangs it through. And so, just like that, with a minute 40 to go in the half, the Volunteers strike quick again, and they've extended their lead. It's now 14-0 in favor of Bessemer Academy, David.
Absolutely. You got to think that takes the wind out of the sails for Bessemer. You can kind of read that body language on the sideline. That hurt, that quick explosive play again. Two explosive plays, and they're on the bottom side of 14-0.
Absolutely. And they were just trying to get in the half, only down 7-0. I think that was you're absolutely right. I think that took a lot of gas out of the tank. Now Hunter Bryan's getting ready to kick off again for the Volunteers, and back deep is number 2, Jeremy Lacey. We've called his name several times tonight, as well as Elijah Moore. Let's see if they get a chance to return it. And there's Hunter Bryan's kick, and it's another boomer, David. I mean, this kid just kicks it out of the end zone every time. That's an amazing weapon to have in high school football, I got to tell you.
We actually had a chance to talk to one of the assistant coaches for Monroe Academy, and they were talking about, what are Craig Bryan's options at the next level. And believe it or not, they actually said if he would settle into a kicking position, they thought he could get offers at the next level.
Well, from what I've seen tonight, I would have to agree with that assessment, that's for sure. It's a nice thing to know that every drive that your opponent starts, they're going to start at the 20-yard line, so you can prepare for that. It gives you that opportunity to kind of pin your ears back and go after them a little bit. So Napier's going to bring him up to the line. He's got two wideouts to the left and a single wideout to the right. He's in the shotgun with the single back, and there's the snap. Looks like he's dropping back to pass. He's looking to go deep. Oh, he was looking for number 15. Hey. That was Matt Kiker. He's been hooking up with all night. But there was that man again. I believe that was number 2, Peyton Powell, was able to dive in front of that and knock it loose, David.
Absolutely. Made a great break on the ball. And you got to love the way Coach Tuberville has this team adjusting. They're playing quarters of the field. All the defensive backs are back. They're waiting to see what happens out in front of them.
Absolutely. Right now, Bessemer's just looking for an answer to this defense. I got to tell you, the defense from the Volunteers right now are really, really putting the pressure on this Bessemer Academy offense. They're having a tough time finding something to run on.
We got a reset of the game clock. The ref is yelling for 1:36 on the clock instead of 1:30. You want to stay with us. You want to stay tuned for the PlayOnSports.com post-game show, where we will select our player of the game as well as wrap up all the action from this ball game. That's coming up following the game on your destination for high school sports, PlayOnSports.com.
Thank you for that, Dave, and you're absolutely right. So far, I'd say we've got several contenders for that player of the game. Napier's dropping back, and he's going to be sacked right there. And this guy's kind of become my partner David's favorite name to call tonight. That's that linebacker he's been telling you about, Colt Carroll. He may only be 5'9", but he plays 6'9" tonight, folks. He's been all over this field. He's able to sack Napier back all the way at the 10-yard line. And I noticed Coach Tuberville here, David, he's taking a timeout. He's looking to get the ball back with a minute and 20 seconds left.
He sure is. He's coming out to show his boys, hey, we're in this. We can't take anything for granted. And I think he wants to send the message to his own team, hey, we don't have these guys done yet. We got to make sure we're doing everything we can do with them.
Absolutely. So he's going to take another timeout, and it's going to bring up third and – looks to be about 20 for the Rebels, David. So far tonight they've had a tough time in the passing game. Napier hasn't had a lot of time to throw the ball, and he has made some good reads, and he's had guys open. But that secondary for the Volunteers has been there to meet them when they've got the ball.
Absolutely. At this level, it's about putting kids in space to make a play, right? So as like you said, the defensive backs have been where they needed to be, when they needed to be, very disciplined. The success that the Rebels have had is when they've done the misdirection and they've done the counters, they've let their line go left to right, and they've allowed their backs to go north and south. And when you let that happen, you'll have some success.
Absolutely. And as we talked at the beginning of the show, both of these are you know, tradition-rich programs. They've played for state titles. They've won state titles. This is this big game environment is nothing new for either one of these ball clubs, and they're and we're seeing that tonight. I mean, Bessemer Academy's down 14-0, but they absolutely have nothing to drop their head about. They're playing a fine football team in Monroe Academy, and this is two Titans going at it right now, David.
That's right.
Okay, Napier's back out on the field, and they're going four wide this time, two to each side. Napier's in the shotgun. He's dropping back. He's looking for somebody, and he finds a man over the middle sliding across. That's his man, number 15, Matt Kiker. They hook up yet again. But, you know, David, that's a nice game, but it's still going to bring them up way short of the first down. It's going to still bring up third and about 12, it looks like.
Coach Tuberfield is going crazy on the sideline over there. He's all the way out. He's almost to midfield right now.
He sure is. He's not happy with a call or something on the field.
It's the clock. He doesn't like the clock. The clock ran down to 101, and he wants it at 112.
Oh, and we've also got a flag on the play, David. They've called the Rebels, Bessemer Caddy, for a legal shift there. So that's gonna negate that gain.
Yeah, you got to think they're going to decline that since they were able to break that up.
I would think so, even though they did pick up about 8 yards. It'll still bring up fourth down for the Rebels, and that's exactly what they've done. They're gonna decline the penalty, and the Rebels are gonna have to punt with 1:12 here to go in the first half. Noah Napier is gonna be punting, and back to receive is that man with a long touchdown reception just a minute ago, Hunter Glass. But that's going to have to wait just a minute, David. It looks like we've got another timeout on the field.
Yeah, it looks like Coach Tuberville took it. He wants to make sure this return team is ready for what's going to happen.
I was about to say, you think he's cooking up something special there on that return?
Yeah, I think he's going to tell them, look, we're not going to go after this. We're going to do what we call a safe coverage on this. We're going to try to return it. We want the ball in Hunter Glass's hands. You know, they say every great return, there's going to be one missed block and one missed tackle and one great block. We've seen that early with Hunter Glass in these returns.
Absolutely, absolutely. That's the key is to make that first man miss, and that's what you're trying to accomplish. And Hunter Glass, we've seen him all night on both sides of the ball. He's able to do that so far.
And that's back to that senior leadership we talked about. As you go into Friday night and you go into the middle of your schedule, there's that safe return. Look, they're going to give him a blocker back there. They're going to put Jake. Jake's going to come back with him.
That's the quarterback, Jake McKenzie. Again, like you were saying earlier, David, that's the thing you got to love about high school football. At this level, these guys aren't just quarterbacks. Usually they're their best athlete on your team, and so you want them to be able to touch the ball as much as possible.
Absolutely.
So we've got two return men back now deep for the Volunteers. They're just on the other side of midfield, and there's Napier's kick. This is the first nice high kick he's had all night, and nice kick. Hunter Glass has to call for the fair catch at his own 45-yard line, so there was no return. That was a nice 45-yard punt there by Noah Napier.
And another great special teams play by Jeremy Lacey, because what he was able to do from that gunner position, he got off his block, and he made it where Hunter Glass had to call a fair catch.
Absolutely. That's the third or fourth time you've mentioned tonight what a great special teams player he is. He's, of course, back out on the field. Nice, tall, free safety back there for the Rebels. And here comes Jake McKenzie. They're in the, they've got him spread out four wide. They're going to go right at him here with just over a minute left in the half. McKenzie drops back to pass. He's looking for a man. He throws it down deep, and he tries to hit the out route to number 16. That was Caleb Smith, and it was incomplete, but there is a flag on the play. I believe Jalen Winston might have got there just a touch early, David.
Yeah, I'm with you, Steve. I definitely believe that. I think when he came over top of his shoulder with his hand, I think the ref had to throw it on that one.
Absolutely. So they're going to mark off 15 yards against the Rebels, and that's going to put them in, put the Volunteers in Rebel territory with 59 seconds to go. They've got it first and 10 from the Rebel 40-yard line, and they've got three wide outs and a single backfield back there with McKenzie.
And dare I say, with Craig Bryan, they're already in field goal range.
I would tend to have to agree with you on that point, David. I would like to see it, actually. And, well, we've got another stoppage in play here. Not sure what this is about. The referees wanted to confer on something. And looks like they've got it worked out. Seems to be another issue with the clock, David.
Yeah, he wants 53 on the clock is what the ref is saying. He wants 53.
And it's reading 54.4, so we're going to shave 1.4 seconds off. Oh, no, he was asking for 58. So,
58.
Now we've got two wideouts to the left and one to the right with a single back from McKenzie. And there's the snap. And he fakes the run up the middle and then drops back to pass. He's looking for a man, and he's got nowhere to go. And he's going to be shoved out of bounds. And technically that's going to be a sack there, David, because that was a loss on the play. Nice job there by Shannon Edwards, the defensive back, the 5'10 sophomore. He read the quarterback's eyes, and he chased him all the way out of bounds.
Yeah, you got to love that. And he was actually at nose tackle for that play, believe it or not. They
got
to list
sure
him
is.
As a defensive back, but he was in the thick of things on that one.
Same formation for him, and they're going to the quarterback keeper around right in. Uh-oh. He's making men miss left and right. He goes down the right sideline. And, folks, there is all kind of flags on the field on this play. Looks like we've got a hold against the Volunteers, so that's going to knock out the nice run there by Jake McKenzie down the right sideline. That's going to be negated. Looks like we've got a couple of fouls on the play here, but I think obviously the holding penalty that happened first is going to override things, and Coach Wright's taking off his headset there. Looks like he's going to accept that holding penalty, and back to Volunteers up 10 yards.
Yeah, that block in the back was declined.
Yeah, we had two penalties on the play. You're correct there, David. They had a block in the back and the hold, and they're gonna decline the block in the back because the holding penalty was a spot foul, and it's going to actually push the Volunteers back on the other side of midfield. So they're going to have it. It's going to be second and about 25 from the 48-yard line. We got four wide for McKenzie. He drops back. He's looking for the home run ball again. He throws it out there. He throws it deep. He was looking for his man. That was Caleb Smith streaking down the center of the field, and he just overshot him.
You got to think that was a breakdown in the defense, though. They had two Volunteer receivers behind the coverage. So you got to wonder if the sophomore understood what he was supposed to do on that one. As the sophomore was breaking back, he was trying to make a play on the ball. Luckily, great speed, he was able to make up and close some of the gap.
Yeah, you had that man Jeremy Lacey back there again along with Josh Bowles. And so it's going to bring up third and 25, and he's got an empty backfield with four wideouts. McKenzie's dropping back. He's looking for the deep ball again. He's looking for his man. Uh-oh. It's going to fall incomplete. He was looking for Hunter Glass, and there's a flag on the play. I think they're saying he might the defensive back might have gotten to him a little early, David.
Yeah, I think he's going to call that. Sometimes that play gets called when it's a hit that makes that kind of look on the field. You know, the receiver's up in the air. He can't really protect himself. He hits the ground kind of hard.
Well, you can tell by the noise here at the stadium, David. These Rebel fans don't agree with it. And, you know, we're impartial. We're here to just call this game. But I got to tell you, I'm kind of siding with the Rebels on this one. I thought that was a good defensive play.
Yeah, it's hard to call it. It's hard to call it. And you want the black and white to not be a factor in the game, but with 18 seconds, that's a pivotal call right now.
And I'd like to say we may be having a little fun here on this play, but these refs, they have a lot of things to watch and a lot of things to do. And if you've never officiated a game, these guys do an amazing job with what all of the different things that they have to watch. I think they do an outstanding job.
Absolutely.
But that was a big, big penalty on the Rebels. That gives the Volunteers a shot here. Now they've got it third and six from the 37-yard line of the Rebels. We've got 18 seconds to go in the half. Empty backfield, there's the snap. McKenzie's dropping back the pass, but not this time, folks. He's dropped down. That's number 68. That's Josh Burrell, the 6'1", 220 defensive end. He's a senior, and he makes a big play right there.
Absolutely. That's what you want. You want that senior leadership as we go into the half. That senior leadership helping them right there at the end, stopping the volunteer threat. That's exactly what you got to think Coach Wright wanted from his team.
And as my partner said, that's the end of the first half of play with the Monroe Academy Volunteers leading by a score of 14-0 over the Bessemer Academy Rebels. We'll be back in a few minutes with the PlayOnSports.com halftime show, so don't go anywhere. It's Friday Night Football on PlayOnSports.com, your destination for high school sports.
One match away from immortality.
This is a total team effort.
We're going to try to dictate to you what you're going to do on both offense and defense. We're going to come at you.
One shot.
But now it's time to put the hats on and go get some work done.
They're all going to look to make a statement early.
.16 left to go in this ball game. High formation, third and three from the 45 of the Wolverines. And this time, holy cow! Deion almost hands it to the Westview player. He's going to run us to the 5-10. Touchdown, Wolverines! How did that happen?
Jason
that was
Snyder.
Holy cow! He was in the backfield before the running back could even get the handoff. He took the handoff from Deion.
He took the ball right out of Deion's hands and just...
Holy cow!
Can't say I've seen that one very often.
Snyder comes shooting in from the A-gap. I think Deion froze when he saw him. He's ready to hand off to his running back. He froze when he saw him and just let him have the ball. 12 seconds to go.
Oh, you could hear a pin drop.
5, 4, 3, 2, get the snap off. Last play of the game. Brewster rolls right, gets away from two sacks. Dons wins, sack at the 20-yard line. What a game!
And number 40, Lucas Zinder with the game-saving sack. And there is heartbreak on one sideline and a jubilation on another.
Offset eye for the Grizzlies as Keeney takes it under center. They'll send a man in motion, pitch back to Bird on the sweep. Bird finds a seam. He might go, folks. 20, 15, 10. Drags a tackler. Touchdown! Bird goes 38 yards for the touchdown on the sweep.
One more snap is all it's going to take, and there you have it, folks. Your 2011 Division I Sac Joaquin section champions, the Granite Bay Grizzlies, as they defeat Pleasant Grove 30-24.
Jacqueline Williamson. Her serve is over. Dug by Holt. Giblin going back to Holt near side, cut shot, kept alive, back in one by Cathedral, and this one is out as Caston on Hill sends it wide, and the Cathedral Dons have won the title 16-14 in game five.
Thomas with the ball, swings it out to Norris. Cameron Taylor tried to block that one away. Norris with a strong take, blocked by B.J. Anya. Huge block. Robinson leading the break the other way. Gets it to Grant.
Oh!
Slam dunk Jeremy Grant off the feed from James Robinson. What a play by the Stag.
Runner at third is Chavez. 8-2 the score. Bottom of the seventh. The 1-2. Popped in the air. This should do it. Cortopassi says, it's mine. Now he's fading on it. And he can't make the catch, but Gaff comes in from center field and does.
Congratulations to the St. Mary's Rams, a three-peat. They win it 8-2 against Franklin to take the series 2-0.
This is time to run an offensive set that you've done all through the season in practice.
Yeah, and you also, you know, you get it to your hottest player right now. Just like they're getting it to Eichhorst right here, he's going to try to create some space, find somebody on the backside that's open.
Eichhorst flush out to the right. Oh, breaks free of a player. Eichhorst on his own. Shoots and scores. Bounces the shot home. Kuz can't handle the shot. Eichhorst takes off the shirt and the helmet. And how about that? Alex called it. Eichhorst, after sustaining the injury in the third quarter of play, has scored the game winner with 22 seconds gone in the overtime period. Dogpile on the field. Marin Academy take it. A fantastic finish to this game. And, well, I hope his other ankle isn't hurting after this.
Hancock to his immediate left. Two receivers far side, one near side. Hancock on a counter, right side. He's inside the 10. He bounces off a tackler at the 10. The 5. Touchdown, Helix. And behind Hancock, the field is littered with white jerseys on the turf.
Wow. Hancock not to be outdone by his fellow playmakers on offense, put on a show on that short 12-yard touchdown run. Looked like he was down after 3 yards, just threw a defender on the ground.
As sophomore Chris Carter steps under center in their tight wing formation, Lycos in motion. Second back through is Freeman. Freeman just knocking people over. Look at him run, breaks through, 4 tackles, and now it's just a foot race to the end zone. And Freeman's going to go the distance. Touchdown, Imperial. On the first play of the second half.
Second and 6 for Imperial from their own 47. They're going to give it to Freeman again off the right, left side. And Freeman gets by one wave and down across the 20, 40-yard line. Still on his feet. Look at him run down to the 20-yard line. One man to beat. Gets by him. Touchdown, Freeman. How did he do that? Holy cow. 64-yard touchdown run. His fifth of the game. Royce Freeman, ladies and gentlemen, you're about to see the top rushing and the as I look over to our partners at KXO Radio, the top rusher
wow.
in the San Diego section for the next 2 years.
That's just amazing. That is just amazing. They hit him in the backfield. They hit him at the line of scrimmage. They hit him a couple yards downfield. They hit him again near the goal line.
Keep those Lowell fans quiet over there.
Lum sets it up for Peng. Long, it's out. Low, a magnificent 7 titles in the San Francisco section in dramatic style as they pull out a fantastic victory over a spirited Galileo Lions team. They win the fourth game, 31-29, and they take the 2012 Academic Athletic Association San Francisco section title.
Officials say no 5-second count can be started. Nobody was close enough defensively. Lyle's going to swing left side, Robinson. Here is a backdoor lob
there
for Grant. They've been wanting that all game. And they got it, 50-42. They lulled you to sleep, and then they hit Grant on the back door.
They trail by 2. McMorrow's kick is on the way, and it is good. St. Augustine has their first lead of the game, 21-20, with 25 seconds to play. The senior McMorrow with a huge kick, not the longest of his career, but the biggest of his career.
Oh,
St.
Geez.
Augustine leads it 21-20.
Already lining up. They won't even have to run that one more play. They just acquiesce.
Yeah, why bother?
So there you have it. Your 5-time defending Division III champions, the Cathedral Catholic Dons, running up over and through Olympian 41-0 here from Qualcomm Stadium.
Patriots down 21-17. Great ball game here. Dillon taking it, looking right, throwing it up top to Gaines. It will be caught by Gaines. Oh, my goodness. It looked like the defender had it, but Gaines stole it away from him. Jason Gaines, are you kidding me, my friend? Oh, boy. It looked like for sure we had an interception by the Tories, but As they both were going to the ground, Jason Gaines just wrestled it away from him. Shane Dillon to Jason Gaines on 11-yard play.
Fanchon in the game, now out, replaced by Hayashi, the libero for defense. Wenzel's serve, championship point, ball up in the air. Hayashi's going to bring it back. Richards, deep one, over and three. Free opportunity, look for Wallace, no, they go Becker. Hayashi, then tap over and two by Hollingsworth. Now look for Wallace for the match.
Kathleen Wallace, no better way for the Bulls to finish it than giving it to their senior leader.
25-12, 25-15, and with eight.
On tears, but that's off of basically two big plays.
That's right. That's a great point. It's basically off two big plays. You got to love the way the teams have gone back and forth. Coach Tuberville, we've said it, the way he's adjusted on defense has been nice. He's done it at the right times, got the kids bought into the program. And Coach Wright has nothing to hold his head about. These Rebels are playing hard. They've taken a huge hit by losing their starting running back. They were putting a lot on Chris Edwards' shoulders, and he's out right now. So
not to mention that senior leadership we talked about.
Absolutely, it's going to come down to as old coach for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers used to say, Raheem Morris used to say, next man up. Who's going to be the next man up?
You're exactly right. Great way to put it. And you know, we've had a couple of big stars on both sides of the ball. A couple of names we've called for the Rebels tonight. Jeremy Lacy, you know, he's played a lot on special teams. We talked about him being a gunner as well as returning punts, and he's done some nice things there. Of course, Noah Napier, he's their quarterback, free safety, and punter. So I don't know that that kid's really come off the field at all, David.
Yeah, that's a great call. And as we get ready for that post-game show, we hope that you'd stay tuned for the PlayOnSports.com post-game show, where we'll select our player of the game, as well as we'll wrap up all the action from this ball game. That's coming up following the game on your destination for high school sports, PlayOnSports.com. How will we really pick a player of the game so far?
I got to tell you, David, we got a lot to choose from, and I think in the second half we'll definitely find out who it's going to be. That's for sure. And you know, the big question remains to be seen. Can the Volunteers keep their foot on the gas, or will the Rebels be able to claw their way back? We're about 8 minutes away from finding out the answer, and we'll be back for the second half. And that's going to do it for the Play on Sports Halftime Show. Friday Night Football will return in just a few minutes with the start of the second half right here on your destination for high school sports, PlayOnSports.com.
Match away from immortality.
This is a total team effort.
We're going to try to dictate to you what you're going to do on both offense and defense. We're going to come at you.
One shot at this.
And now it's time to put the hats on and go get some work done.
So they're all going to look to make a statement early.
.16 left to go in this ball game. High formation, third and three from the 45 of the Wolverines. And this time, holy cow! Deion almost hands it to the Westview player. He's going to run this to the 5-10. Touchdown, Wolverines! How did that happen?
Jason
that was
Snyder.
Holy cow! He was in the backfield before the running back could even get the handoff. He took the handoff from Deion.
He took the ball right out of Deion's hands and just...
Holy cow!
Can't say I've seen that one very often.
Snyder comes shooting in from the A-gap. I think Deion froze when he saw him. He's ready to hand off to his running back. He froze when he saw him and just let him have the ball.
12 seconds to go.
Oh, you could hear a pin drop.
5, 4, 3, 2, get the snap off. Last play of the game. Brewster rolls right, gets away from two sacks. Dons wins, sack at the 20-yard line. What a game.
And number 40, Lucas Zinder with the game-saving sack. And there is heartbreak on one sideline and a jubilation on another.
Offset eye for the Grizzlies as Keeney takes it under center. They'll send a man in motion, pitch back to Bird on the sweep. Bird finds a seam. He might go, folks. 20, 15, 10. Drags a tackler. Touchdown! Bird goes 38 yards for the touchdown on the sweep.
One more snap is all it's going to take. And there you have it, folks. Your 2011 Division I Sac Joaquin section champions, the Granite Bay Grizzlies, as they defeat Pleasant Grove 30-24.
Jacqueline Williamson. Her serve is over. Dug by Holt. Giblin going back to Holt near side. Cut shot. Kept alive. Back in one by Cathedral. And this one is out as Caston on Hill sends it wide. And the Cathedral Dons have won the title 16-14 in game five.
Thomas with the ball, swings it out to Norris. Cameron Taylor tried to block that one away. Norris with a strong take, blocked by B.J. Anya. Huge block. Robinson leading the break the other way. Gets it to Grant. Oh. Slam dunk Jeremy Grant off the feed from James Robinson. What a play by the Stag.
Runner at third is Chavez. 8-2 the score. Bottom of the seventh. The 1-2. Popped in the air. This should do it. Cortopassi says, it's mine. Now he's fading on it. And he can't make the catch, but Gaff comes in from center field and does. Congratulations to the St. Mary's Rams, a three-peat. They win it 8-2 against Franklin to take the series 2-0.
This is time to run an offensive set that you've done all through the season in practice.
Yeah. And also, you know, you get it to your hottest player right now. Just like they're getting it to Eichhorst right here. He's going to try to create some space, find somebody on the backside that's open.
Eichhorst flush out to the right. Oh, breaks free of a player. Eichhorst on his own. Shoots and scores. Bounces the shot home. Kuz can't handle the shot. Eichhorst takes off the shirt and the helmet. And how about that? Alex called it. Eichhorst, after sustaining the injury in the third quarter of play, has scored the game winner with 22 seconds gone in the overtime period. Dogpile on the field. Marin Academy take it. A fantastic finish to this game. And, well, I hope his other ankle isn't hurting after this.
Hancock to his immediate left. Two receivers far side, one near side. Hancock on a counter, right side. He's inside the 10. He bounces off a tackler at the 10. The 5. Touchdown, Helix. And behind Hancock, the field is littered with white jerseys on the turf.
Wow. Hancock not to be outdone by his fellow playmakers on offense. Put on a show on that short 12-yard touchdown run. Looked like he was down after 3 yards. Just threw a defender on the ground.
As sophomore Chris Carter steps under center. In their tight wing formation, Lycos in motion. Second back through is Freeman. Freeman just knocking people over. Look at him run. Breaks through. Four tackles. And now it's a foot race to the end zone. And Freeman's going to go the distance. Touchdown, Imperial, on the first play of the second half.
Second and 6 for Imperial from their own 47. They're going to give it to Freeman again off the right, left side. And Freeman gets by one wave and down across the 20, 40-yard line. Still on his feet. Look at him run down to the 20-yard line. One man to beat. Gets by him. Touchdown, Freeman. How did he do that? Holy cow. 64-yard touchdown run. His fifth of the game. Royce Freeman, ladies and gentlemen, you're about to see the top rushing and the as I look over to our partner.
You're watching PlayOnSports.com's presentation of Friday Night Football live from Bessemer, Alabama. I'm Steve Hall. with David Sauls, my partner, and we've got a great game here tonight. The visiting team from Monroe Academy leads the homestanding Bessemer Academy Rebels by a score of 14-0 as we get ready to start the second half of action. And, David, as we went to break, we were talking about it. Other than the couple of long, you know, couple of big plays, you know, McKenzie was able to hit his man, Hunter Glass, for a long touchdown, 80-yard touchdown, and that was in the second quarter. And in the first quarter, you had Justin Rowell break down about a 58-yard run, and that's your only two scores of the game so far.
That's right. Definitely not sustained drives, definitely not wearing down the defense, big explosive plays. You got to think, the Volunteers deferred to the second half, so let's see what happens. See if they're going to come out and say they really want to take that ball or where they're going to go with it.
Absolutely, and as we get ready to start the second half, we also want to bring along some well wishes to Bessemer Academy Rebel number 22, Chris Edwards, who was injured in the first half. We haven't been able to get a word on his extent of his injury, but we do know he won't be out there in the second half. So look for the young sophomore, 6'2", 190-pounder Jalen Winston, to fill his slot there at the right defensive end, David.
Absolutely. He'll take him on defense. And then it's going to come back to Elijah Moore, the 5'8", 175-pound running back. He's a sophomore also. He's kind of doing the duties that Edwards was doing on the offensive side of the ball. So here we go. These two sophomores are going to have to show what they're worth tonight.
Absolutely, and both of these clubs try to run the spread offense, and so far Bessemer Academy's been trying to find a way to stay away from Colt Carroll tonight. The inside linebacker seems like he's been in on every play for the Volunteers.
Absolutely, the big two, number zero, he's been everywhere. You know, I'm partial to the small guys. I love the little 5'9", 155-pounder out there taking care of business.
Absolutely, he's done a great job tonight, locking down the middle, also making plays outside. We'll have to see here in the second half if looks like the Volunteers, I believe, will be getting the kickoff, if that's not correct, David. And we'll see if Jake McKenzie can sustain a drive here, because I look for him, as we called it in the first half, we thought they would put their foot on the gas. I look for him in the second half, like you said, to try to find that more sustainable drive and start to wear down this younger, maybe a little bit thinner Rebel defense.
Yeah, I think that's a great call, and that's definitely what we're seeing in this chess match as Tuberville and Wright lock horns here. We got to see. I got to tell you, the Rebel special teams is coming out. They look energized. They don't have their heads down. They think they're still in this ball game.
Absolutely, and we had you had three turnovers in the first half. Bessemer Academy had a fumble and an interception that they lost. And on the other side, you know, that's kind of a wash because the Volunteers, they had a punt blocked, and then they also had an interception. So from a turnover standpoint, I'd say they're even right now.
Yeah, definitely a push. You definitely haven't seen them capitalize on those turnovers the way we thought they would.
Absolutely, and it looks like here we're ready to go for the second half, David. We're just starting the third quarter, and the Rebels are going to be kicking off. Noah Napier is going to be kicking off, and back deep for the Volunteers is going to be number one, Hunter Glass, and he's also got a partner over there, and it looks like that to be the quarterback, number four, Jake McKenzie. So here we go, folks, live from Bessemer. We're starting the third quarter, Friday Night Football on Play On Sports. There's Noah Napier's kick. It's taken at about the 5-yard line by the quarterback, Jake McKenzie, and it's a middle return. He comes straight up the gut, and he's going to get back to about the 20, and that's it before he's met initially there by number 44, Shannon Edwards. They've got him listed as a defensive back, the sophomore, but we noticed he was playing some nose tackle there in the first half, David.
Absolutely, and you got to love Jarrell Moore coming up there, 5'9", 230-pound. He's really been on special teams, and he really made a hustle play to get down there.
All right, here we go. Jake McKenzie's going to bring his Volunteer squad out onto the field. Let's see if they're going to keep it spread out, and it looks like they are. They've got a single wideout to the left with two wideouts to the right, and he's got two backs in the backfield, kind of pretty much what we've seen all night out of the Volunteers, David.
Yeah, it looks like they're going with, if it's not broke, don't fix it kind of mentality. Got to get that tee off the field. Coaches are reacting to that after that long kickoff.
Absolutely. Got a little delay right there. Now Jake McKenzie's in the shotgun with his two backs. He's ready for the ball. And there's the snap, and it's a quick inside handoff. And that looks like big number 30.
It does. Looks like Craig Bryan getting one of his first carries of the game.
And that could be a key to what we're talking about, David. It's time to start pounding that big fullback up the middle. And he's going to be going straight up against Shannon Edwards, the nose guard there. And, well, it doesn't look like he was in on that play. Looks like number 18, Rodriguez McKinney, the big 6'3" man, was in on the stop there. Got the same look, except this time we've got two wideouts to the right and one to the left. And there's the snap, and it's a handoff straight up the middle. Little quick hitter. And that was number 11, Justin Rowell, the man with the touchdown earlier tonight on the carry. He takes it up the gut, picks up about 3 yards, brought down by their number 70, Matthew Williamson, and it's going to bring up 3rd and 4 for the Volunteers.
Yeah, you got to like what Coach Wright and his defensive staff are doing. They've gone with a bigger defensive line as the second half has opened up. They got all their big guys. Their smallest guy on the defensive line right now is 6'3".
Absolutely, and there's the handoff.
Fumble.
Oh, the ball's loose. The ball's loose. Bessemer Academy's picked it up. He's rumbling down the right sideline, and that could be that key turnover we're looking for. And help me out there, David. I believe that was Sidney Moore, the outside linebacker, that picked up that fumble and started rumbling down the right sideline.
Absolutely. You got to say Bessemer Academy sophomores are showing up tonight. He got that thing, and he started scrambling down the side. Big Crick Bryan running that ball, and somebody comes in there and puts a hat on it.
Absolutely, and as we were talking to Coach Wright before the game, he did tell us that, you know, his Rebels are young, and we see a lot of those sophomores, like you say, showing up tonight. This bodes well for the future of this program under Coach Wright here at Bessemer.
Absolutely.
We've got a late addition onto the field for the Rebels as they take the ball. That's Jarrell Moore coming into the game at fullback. And Noah Napier looks like he's going to go under center this time, and they're in the power eye, it looks like.
A little wishbone out there.
Yeah, they do have a little wishbone.
Uh-oh,
fumble on the exchange. I think Noah Napier was able to dive on the ball there, and it even might have went forward a little bit. And it looks like the Rebels are going to retain possession, David, and it's going to bring up 2nd and goal. And from where we are in this corner, it looks to be there on about the 5-yard line. And we're just 10:43 left in the 3rd quarter here. So we've got a lot of football left to play, David.
Absolutely. You got to like that wishbone look. They're coming down there saying, hey, we want to run this thing too.
And we've got back there the deep man is going to be number 24, Sidney Moore. Back there also is Drake St. John and Jarrell Moore. Noah Napier is under center.
Yeah, the small back in this formation is 185 pounds. So this is what you'd call a heavy package right here.
I'd say that's what they refer to as the big bone, isn't it?
The big bone, that's right, the big bone.
Absolutely. So here we go. Let's see. It's going to be 2nd. The yard marker is going to be incorrect over there. It is going to be 2nd down. Napier fumbles the snap again. They're having some center quarterback exchange issues there, David. Is this from them not going under center very much?
Yeah, you got to wonder what's happening out there. Got to see that call there. I can't tell if they're using their freshman center or if they have their senior center out there.
And after those two fumbled exchanges, the Bessemer's going to take a timeout and talk about how to get the ball back to Noah Napier at quarterback.
Yeah, and that's the kind of stuff that those are drive killers there. When you start stalling, when you've got momentum on your side, you really want to go ahead and be able to punch that thing in right there. Two miscues right here as we're down here. And it's not the first time that they've threatened. They're threatening right now, and it'd sure be nice for them to get a score and get something underneath their belt.
Absolutely, and it cuts it to a one-score margin with basically the whole second half here left to play, David. So this game is far from over.
Far from over. Do you want to watch more of your school's great matchups, like the game you're enjoying here tonight? Tell your school to sign up for the Play On Sports School Broadcast Program. The program allows schools to broadcast all their games and other activities on the web. For more information, go to playonsports.com/SBP.
Thanks for that, David. That was just in time. It looks like the Rebels have decided what they're going to do. They're out of the timeout here, and it's going to bring up 3rd and goal, but now they're back on about the 10-yard line. And now they're going back to the shotgun with two wideouts to the right and one to the left, and in the shotgun. And it's going to be a quarterback keeper, and he's lost the ball. There's a fumble on the play, and Monroe Academy comes up with it. I'm going to try to get you a number there. Looks like it's your man again, David. I'm going to say it's number 20, Colt Carroll, the man with the nose for the football. He's been around it all night long.
You know, you got to wonder, Steve. I'm thinking if maybe we've got a hand injury to Noah, the way he's handling that ball. That's the third time in a row he's been able to put it on the ground. Maybe the young man has suffered an injury and he's still trying to play through it.
Absolutely. You could be correct on that because there's obviously something going on. So Jake McKenzie brings his volunteers back out on the field. They're backed up deep in their own territory at their own 10-yard line, first and 10. He's coming out with two wideouts to the right and one to the left with his two backs. They're in that same spread. He's dropping back to pass. He's going for the home run ball here, David. It's thrown deep. Oh, and it's off the hands at midfield. He was looking for his man, Hunter Glass. But, David, there's a late flag there on the play. It looks like they're going to get number 21, Josh Bowles, on a pass interference call.
Yeah, and that the crowd definitely reacting to that down here in front of us. They don't like that call at all. They think it was a good aggressive play, but referee saw it a different way.
Absolutely, and he's right there to make the play and, you know, make the call. And so that's going to get the – it's going to get the volunteers a little bit better field position. That's going to bring them up to the 25-yard line where it's going to be first and 10. And if you're just joining us, we've got 10 minutes to go here in the third quarter, and the Monroe Academy Volunteers lead the Bessemer Academy Rebels 14-0, and they've got the ball first and 10 on their own 25-yard line. McKenzie with his spread offense. He's going to take a quick hitter right up the middle.
That's big Craig Bryan coming up through the middle. Number 62, Chase Smith. He's been quiet a little bit here in the beginning of the second half, but he comes in there and puts a hat on him.
Two big bulls meeting there, but not before Craig Bryan was able to pick up seven nice yards on that quick hitting right off the belly fullback. Looks like a fullback dive they're running there, David.
Absolutely. They're still testing the middle of that Rebel defense. We talked about that early on. They're still testing it. They think they can be successful there.
And McKenzie's in the shotgun with his two backs again. Bryan's still back there. And now they're going to try a quick handoff on the other side. And he's going to plow up right up the left side. That was number 11, Justin Rowell. And it looks like he's going to have enough for the first down.
Yeah, I can't tell where the spot is.
And
on
there,
that.
It there is. It is. There's the mark from the official. It's a first down for the Volunteers. Could be that drive we're looking for, David. It seems like they could smell blood in the water here, and they're going to try to wear down that aggressive Bessemer Academy defense.
Yeah, I definitely think that's what they're doing. They're trying to get a good sustained drive here, but they're not afraid to go deep with it either.
No, and they've spread them out again, two wide to the right and one to the left, and there's a quick hitting with the fullback, number 30, Bryan again. He's met almost instantly, though, and fights forward for a couple of yards. And there's Noah Napier coming up, sticking his helmet in there to make a play.
Yeah, you like to see that run support from your safety. But, again, we talked about it earlier, you know, one of your best athletes on the field, you get a little nervous when he gets in there, comes up hitting the 255-pounder.
Absolutely, and they're still spreading them out. They've got two wides, one on each side, and he's got his two backs back there in the shotgun. He's going to take the snap. He's going to hand it off on the right side. That's
Justin Rowell coming in again.
That is Justin Rowell again coming around, trying to cut it back off the right guard there, and he picks up a couple of yards, and it's going to bring up third and about five for the Volunteers.
You got to love that pass interference call, too. Remember in high school, it's not at the spot of the foul, so that kind of played well for the Rebels on that particular offense.
Absolutely, absolutely. He's in the shotgun, and here it is, another quick handoff to Justin Rowell, and he busts right up the gut. He's still on his feet. He's still going, dragging a Rebel defenders with him. He's finally brought down by number 62, Chase Smith. But not before he rips off about 20 yards there, David. And that's good for another Volunteer first down. And we see that spread offense. It's starting to spread those Rebels a little thin, and they're going right at that middle.
That's exactly what they're doing, part of that chess match. Spread that defense so you only have to get through one level to make a big play.
Absolutely. Now it looks like the Rebels are going to walk up their secondary here to put them right on the line. It's kind of a high snap. McKenzie's able to grab it, and then he's trying to dump it over the middle. He was looking for number 18, Ethan Nall, but it falls just a little short, a little high on the snap there. David kind of threw off their timing a little bit, I would say.
Yeah, how do you like that play call, though, Steve?
absolutely wonderful. I mean, it was a looked kind of like a QB fake there up the middle, and he pulls it back, and then he just kind of dumps it over the middle. He's looking for his man coming across the end there and just missed him.
So, yeah, we've seen Jake do that a couple times tonight, take that one or two steps towards the line to see if he can get the safeties to react to him.
Absolutely, and Bessemer continues to walk their DBs up. They've got 8 men in the box. They're trying to stop this big fullback, but here he is. He's able to get outside just a little bit, and that was Brian again on the carry. He picks up about 5 yards, so it's going to bring up third and five. Tackle again by number 62, Chase Smith. He's getting a lot of tackles in there tonight at that linebacker position.
Yeah, and you got to think Chase is coming in about 170. So he's given up a little bit of a weight to the big fullback. So it's all about pad level when you get that kind of a discrepancy on the weight side of things.
Absolutely. And Brian stays in the backfield along with Rowell. McKenzie's got him in the shotgun. They've got a single wide out to the left and a single to the short side of the field here on the right. Brian moves up in the wingback position. And it's a direct snap to McKenzie, and he breaks to the left. And he's still going. He's around the left side. And he's going to have another volunteer first down, David. That was a nice quick hitter off the left tackle there. Nice job by the left tackle to cave in that side there.
Absolutely. You got to love it when the big guys get out there and do what they're supposed to do. That big left tackle getting out there and just really pushing that down. You know, a lot of times you only hear those guys' name called when they do something wrong. But big number 58. He's out there, big Malcolm Hughes, taking care of business.
We're spread again. We've got two to the right and one to the left. And Craig Bryan comes in motion to a wingback position with a single back. And it's quick handoff to number 11. He fights up the middle. He's still on his feet. That's Justin Wowell running hard. Picks up about 6 yards. And we've got a nice about 4-minute drive here, David, that we were talking about. It looks like they could be wearing down that Bessemer Academy defense.
Yeah, and you got to wonder about that, too. You know, you see this a lot of times in high school, especially some of these kind of matchups. You got kids playing both ways on both sides of the ball and both teams. And but once you get that momentum going, you know, they've been on the field for a long time right now.
Absolutely. And McKenzie's up and ready to go again with his two backs in the backfield, two wideouts to the right and single to the left. And it looks to be the same play again. Craig Bryan going back to the wingback spot on the left, and it's a direct snap to McKenzie, and he follows the big man right up the hole. He dives for the pylon, and he's in for the touchdown. Wow, what a nice run there by number 4, Jake McKenzie. 15-yard touchdown run following his big fullback right off the left tackle there, David.
Absolutely, and you called it too. That switch to bring Craig Bryan up and then move him into that kind of that wing back, that flanker position, really opens up the edge there.
Absolutely. Nice job by the volunteers there on that left side of the line. Craig Bryan's in for the extra point now. There's the snap, the hold, it's down, and it is good. So, with 5:36 to go in the third quarter, Monroe adds to their lead to now make it 21-0 over the Bessemer Academy Rebels.
Yeah, it's going to be really important how the Bessemer Academy Rebels respond on this return.
Absolutely. You couldn't be more. I think we just heard it here in the crowd, David. The fans are calling for them not to quit, you know. And, you know, from what I've seen so far tonight, these young Rebels, they got a lot of heart, a lot of fight left in them. I don't think this game's over by a long shot.
No, not at all. These kids are here to fight. They want to play. They practice all week so they can put on the pads on Friday night.
Craig Bryan's getting ready to kick off for the Monroe Academy Volunteers. And back deep to receive for the Rebels is number 2, Jeremy Lacey, and number 7, Elijah Moore. Once again, that's a pair of sophomores back there, David.
Yeah, you gotta love the sophomores stepping up. They've really shown what they can do this game.
And there's Brian's kick, and he booms it yet again, David, right into the back of the end zone. Elijah Moore's back there to catch it, but there's no return in high school once it breaks the plane of the goal line. So yet another touchback. So that's, if I'm not mistaken, that's 4 kickoffs and 4 touchbacks.
Absolutely. He's definitely got the foot for what he's doing right now.
I'd say he's grading out at an A-plus on the kicking side. And on that last drive, his blocking not too shabby either, David.
That's right. Yeah, I was talking to one of the assistant coaches. They said that he's had interest from Troy. So he's looking to take the next step and play on a Saturday morning.
Absolutely, and from what we've seen here today, he's definitely has the skill set to do that. That's for sure. Now Bessemer Academy is going to have the ball first and 10 from their own 20-yard line, 5:36 to go here in the third quarter. If you're just joining us, you're listening to us and watching us on playonsports.com. We're live in Bessemer, Alabama. Noah Napier's in the shotgun with a single back, two wideouts to the left, one to the right. It's a quick handoff.
There's Drake.
There's Drake St. Thomas. And I got to tell you, that's one of the most effective run plays I've seen all night. That quick hitter off the left side. Nice job there by number 77, the big left tackle, Tyler Scazzaro. He was able to seal his man on the edge and open the hole for Drake.
Yeah, you got to like Drake St. John crashing down like that. You know, the young man, he's a load, too. He's coming in 205, but when you pack that in a 5'9" frame, you got all man-child out there.
Absolutely. Napier takes the snap, hands it to him again. They're running the same way. He buries the shoulder pad, and he runs right into number 8 there. That's Daniel Whitehead, first time we've called his name tonight, a 5'10" senior outside linebacker. He's able to make the stop, but not before not before Drake is able to pick up about 5 yards on the play, David.
Yeah, we go back to that pad level comment. You know, Drake just showed it right there. Yeah, his pads were lower than what Daniel brought, and that's never a good equation if you're on the high side of that.
Well, like my coach always told us, just because you're the running back doesn't mean you have to take the hit. You can deliver it as well.
That's right.
Noah Napier hands off again, this time in the backfield, switching it up a little bit. That's number 44, Shannon Edwards. But there is nowhere to go. They're big number 75, Cameron Brasher, the nose tackle. He just eats that up, David.
Sure does. And you're talking, when you say big, you're not playing around. A joker 6'3", 295 pounds. Not only did he eat it up, but he was actually going for the ball. He had strip written all over that one.
Absolutely, and he's just an 11th grader, so he's still got another year to grow. He really clogs that middle up nice for the Volunteers.
Yeah, you like to have a big plugger like that in the middle, just plug some holes for you.
Absolutely, because you know he's taking on two or three blocks every play. Noah Napier's in the shotgun with a single back. He drops back to pass. He's got three wideouts, and he hits his man in the flat. That's number he completes it to number 18, Rodriguez McKinney, the 6'3" senior. He picks up about 4 yards, but it's still going to be about 3 yards to go, and they're just shy of midfield. What are we at in the game, David? We got 3:45 here to go in the third quarter, and it looks like the Rebels are going to go for it.
They're going to go for it. They're looking at wristbands. Coach Wright is putting it on the line right here, right at midfield.
Big play right here, I'd say, David. I mean, I know it might be a little bit earlier, but this could be what they've got to have. And they're running a little option here, and there's the pitch, but it's on the ground, and it's fumbled. They're able to get back on it, but at this point it doesn't really matter because it's not past the line of scrimmage, so that's going to be a turnover on downs. Great job there by Connor Morgan, the cornerback, to string that thing out and pick up the pitch man.
Yeah, and Sidney Moore did everything he could to cover that thing up. You know, that when that pitch hit the ground like that, number 24 for Bessemer Academy, he really reacted to that well. That's what you want to see when the ball is on the ground.
Absolutely. So with the change of possession, we're going to take one of our water breaks here. And with 3:21 to go in the third quarter, your score is Monroe Academy Volunteers 21, the Bessemer Academy Rebels 0.
One match away from immortality.
This is a total team effort.
We're going to try to dictate to you what you're going to do on both offense and defense. We're going to come at you.
One shot.
Now it's time to put the hats on and go get some work done.
They're all going to look to make a statement early.
Play On Sports is on Facebook and Twitter, giving you news and information and the links to great highlights. Follow us at Play On Sports on both Facebook and Twitter. You can also access thousands of live and on-demand games on YouTube at youtube.com/playonnetwork. Keep up with all the high school action every week from your destination for high school sports. It's playonsports.com.
All right, David, we're back, and after the change of possession, we had a timeout on the field, and both the coaches, Coach Tupperville and Coach Wright, are talking to their teams right now and trying to assess what they need to do on this series right here.
Yeah, you got to think, you know, here's a pivotal moment right here. We want to make sure that we're settling things down and we're getting into a groove and we're trying to make things happen here with 3:21 left in the third quarter.
Do the volunteers here want to do that sustainable drive again and continue to pound the middle? Is that what they're looking to do, David?
Yeah, I would absolutely say that. I think you're right. When you made that call coming out of the break at halftime, they had put the foot on the gas just like we thought they would do at the end of the first half. They were going to come out the second half, and they were going to go to that big fullback, just kind of grind this thing out. Remember, the clock is on their side right now for Monroe Academy. 21-0 is not an insurmountable obstacle, but it's an obstacle at this point.
Yeah, and you couldn't be more right, David. And it's even tougher when you don't have the ball.
That's right.
So I look for Monroe to really try to control this game in the trenches now. Use the big fullback, quick hitters to Justin Rowell, and really try to chew some of this clock up.
Yeah, and there's some adjustments that can still be made on defense for the Bessemer Academy Rebels. They're definitely not out of this. Like we've said all night long, these young men have nothing but fight, lights of heart. They're still in this thing. They're still engaged. Nobody's dropping their head. They're still in this thing. So, you know, a strip and a capitalization on a turnover could really just swing momentum their way.
Absolutely. And it looks like that defensive coordinator Jeremy Perkins and the defensive backs coach Ben Esner have been talking, and I noticed those last few plays when Monroe had the ball on their last drive, it looked like Bessemer was walking their safeties and corners up and putting 8, 9, one time even 10 men in the box.
That's right, and that's kind of what you got to do when you want to slow down that run. But again, you've said it, this Jake McKenzie, he's got an arm. He's thrown 30, 40 yards, and he's been accurate. So you don't want Bessemer to get caught in that either.
Absolutely, and out of the timeout here, it looks like they're spreading them out still. They've got three wideouts to the left, one to the right with a single back there. Jake McKenzie's got Justin Rowell back there with him, and there's the snap, and he's dropping back the pass. He's looking deep in the right corner. He's looking for his man, and he hits the home run ball to Hunter Glass 50 yards down the right sideline, and just like that, as we're talking about the sustainable drive, they put their foot on the gas again, and now it's 27-0, and it looks like that really has deflated the wind out of the sails here for these Rebels.
Yeah, we talked about the safeties not getting complacent and not creeping up in for that run, and like you said, once they spread it, it was one-on-one man coverage down at the bottom of the screen, and Hunter Glass made a great catch.
Absolutely, and it was right on the money. Craig Bryan's in to attempt the extra point, and there's the snap. There's the hold, and it is good. So with 3:11 to go in the third quarter, new score, Monroe Academy Volunteers 28, the Bessemer Academy Rebels nothing.
And you're looking at 3:11 left to go in the third quarter. It's going to be important. Again, we talk about reaction. And, you know, it's not always the situation you're in, but it's how you react to that situation. And Bessemer Academy has a chance to react to a situation. Back to the point after kicking by Craig Bryan. There's a railroad track running back behind the baseball stadium here. I'm pretty sure that young man's going for the tracks.
Well, he very well could have been, and here comes another kickoff by him. And I'm going to go out on a limb here, David, and say that Rebels are going to go ahead and set up shop at the 20-yard line because this man tonight so far, Craig Bryan, is 4-for-4 on touchbacks.
Well, I think you're on a strong limb then, brother. You're on a strong limb.
Here's the kick by Bryan. The whistle's up. His hand's down. Here we go. And it's a kick right down the middle, and once again, it's right out the back of the end zone. Yeah, I'll tell you what, I've never seen a high school kicker that's more consistent than this young man right here tonight, David.
Absolutely, and when he says consistent, Steve's not even telling half the story. The guy is right down the middle of the field with this. He's putting the ball where he wants it, when he wants it.
Absolutely. You can tell he takes a lot of pride in his and his kicking game and kicking ability. And he's out there on defense. He's out there on offense. You know, we talked a lot of these kids go both ways. But, you know, some of these guys are going three ways because they're playing all the special teams plays as well. And Bessemer's going to break the huddle with 3:11 to go here in the third quarter. They're now trailing 28-0. They've got the ball first and 10 on their own 20-yard line. And it looks like, David, we're going to have a change in quarterback. And the new quarterback in is going to be number 15, Matt Kiker, who's been playing wide receiver all night. And he's dropping back first play, dropping back to pass, and he's looking for number 12 over the middle, Dallas Kahn. But, David, he didn't have a lot of time to throw that ball.
No, he didn't. And you gotta wonder about that quarterback change and making it. Now is the time to make it if you're going to make one. But at the same time, you know, you got to wonder if there's an injury to Noah. We talked about that throwing hand and some of those drops. Maybe the coaching staff knows something we don't know.
Absolutely, and I believe that was Craig Bryan right in his face as he tried to complete the pass. Up, and there's a fumble. There's a fumble on the exchange. Looked like that was going to be a fake to the left tailback, and that was Drake St. John, and I think he wanted to keep it, and so they had a little trouble in the exchange. So it's going to drop him back a few more yards. It's going to bring up third and 13. So it's third and 13, and they're going to try to spread it out. They've got two wideouts to the left, one to the right with a single back. And as we mentioned, now in a quarterback is Matt Kiker, and he's dropping back to pass. He's under heavy pressure, and he's hit. And he throws it just as he's hit back there. He was met by number 20 and number 8. That's Daniel Whitehead and Colt Carroll yet again, two of those fine volunteer linebackers. They met at the quarterback. And the pass falls incomplete over the middle, David.
Yeah, Watson Kennedy in there also from that inside linebacker position. Noah is back to take the punt, though, but it looks like he's holding his left thumb gingerly.
It does, and I do believe I see some tape on there as well, David. Nice eye from up here for you to catch that. So he's going to be dropping back for the punt. There's the punt. It's off. It's going to land at about midfield, and Hunter Glass is just going to back off and let that one roll. And it's going to roll dead at the Volunteer 45-yard line. So great field position for the Volunteers as they take over. And as we've seen tonight, David, when they're not under the shadow of their own goalpost, they're not afraid to go for it right off the bat on first down.
That's right. Another great special teams play by these sensational sophomores for Bessemer Academy. 21 Josh Bowles down there, another sophomore. Hunter Glass has a chance to pick that ball up and run. But Josh is right there on top of him and kind of persuaded him not to do that.
Absolutely. And so with 2:18 to go here in the third quarter, it's the Volunteers 28-0 over the Bessemer Academy Rebels. And they've got the ball first and 10 on their own 45-yard line, just shy of midfield. And they're coming out in the spread yet again. They've got two to the left and one to the right with a single back. And here's the snap to Jake McKenzie. He's dropping back to pass. And he's under duress, and he's going to be dropped for the sack. That was number 68, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. That was Josh Burrell, 6'1", senior defensive end in on the sack there, David.
And we got some laundry back here in the backfield, so in the defensive backfield. So let's see what's happening over here.
And it looks like the Bessemer Academy Rebels are cheering on that one. Oh, we've got a personal foul, against Monroe Academy. Not sure if that's going to be a dead ball personal foul, but I believe it is, David. So it's going to bring up second down and 25.
Yeah, I got to tell you, I missed it, Steve. I was watching the quarterback get sacked, and I missed the altercation that happened back here in the defensive backfield.
You and I both were. I didn't see it. It must have been a late hit or a inadvertent hit, something of that nature. So after the step off, it's going to bring up second, and you know it's a short cab ride actually for the Volunteers. It's going to bring up second and 25, but with Jake McKenzie's arm, we know this is something they've picked up tonight. They've got three wideouts to the right and one to the left and a single back. They're really spreading them out now, David.
They are.
There's the snap. It was a high snap. Quick inside handoff to number 11. That's Justin Rowell. They had him spread out, David. They were going to try to hit him with that quick inside trap handoff again, but the Rebels were there ready for it this time.
Yeah, and you got to like this. It's another defensive line change by Coach Wright. We seen them come out. They had their big 6'3" McKinney out there. They had their real tall guy Matt Williams out there. Matt 6'7".
Jarrell Moore's out there.
Yeah, so now they're mixing it up now. So now they're bringing in some of their stouter guys, if you will. So they've went from that real big front defensive line to now they've got guys in there to play against the run.
And it's going to bring up third and about 25 still for the Volunteers. And they've got a bunch package with a single wide out to the left. And here comes a quick handoff to Justin Rowell around the right side. He gets nice yardage, but as far as they were, that's still going to bring up a punting situation. He was met there initially by number 24, Sidney Moore, another sophomore, and also Noah Napier, the junior free safety.
Yeah, you got to think Coach Wright, when he looks at this game tape, he's going to be happy with the way the sophomores stood up. And like you said, Steve, a couple of those sophomores did not start tonight. They came in due to injury.
Absolutely. You're absolutely correct. Well, we've got our man number 30, Craig Bryan, back to punt, and he's punting deep to number 21, Josh Bowles, and it's a big high kick. Bowles takes it at the 20 on a dead run. He's streaking up the sideline. He's breaking three tackles so far. He's still on his feet. He's still going, pushing the pile, David. Absolutely. What a tremendous run there by number 21. His helmet's off, and he's still going. I think he took a hit from everybody on the Monroe Academy punt return team, David. But once again, hang on just a second. I see a flag back down here around the 30-yard line, David.
Yeah, I think that's going to be called on Shane Edwards, because I don't think he got his helmet around in front of number 55, Watson. I don't think he got around there, so I think they're going to get him calling for a block in the back.
Yep, and that looks to be the call, David. And boy, that's going to take away big field. That's going to be a big flop in field position for Bessemer Academy. They had the ball well on the other side of midfield into Monroe Academy territory now, David. And as a result of the penalty, they're going to be starting at their own 20-yard line, which seems to be where they've started all their drives tonight.
That's true, but with just a little bit of time left here in the third quarter, this could be a good little chance. They'll switch field here in a second, and it'll be like starting all over again.
And Matt Kiker's going to stay in at quarterback, and there's the snap. He's going to throw a quick out, and uh-oh, it's tipped. Oh, and it was almost picked off there by number 24, Connor Morgan. Had it in his hands, David. Boy, I bet he'd like to have that one back.
I bet he would. Hey, we've talked about it all night. These defensive backs for the Volunteers, they've been trying to sniff out that play. We thought it was only a matter of time until one of them stepped in front of one.
Well, and we've seen on a couple plays tonight, both of these defenses are well schooled on the tip drill. There's
Absolutely.
No doubt about it. And on that play, that's going to bring us to the end of the third quarter, folks. It's we're here in Bessemer, Alabama, where the visiting Monroe Academy Volunteers are leading the homestanding Bessemer Academy Rebels 28-0 as we start the fourth quarter, David.
Absolutely. Play on Sports. We're on Facebook and Twitter, giving you the news, the information, the links to great highlights. Follow us at Play on Sports on both Facebook and Twitter. You can also access thousands of live and on-demand games on YouTube at youtube.com/playonnetwork. Keep up with all the high school action every week, because you know playonsports.com, it's your destination for high school sports.
All right, David, so as Bessemer Academy comes out to start the fourth quarter, what can we look to see from their offense right now?
Well, you got to think that a little bit of, you know, the time is not in their favor right now. They've got 12 minutes left in this game, and you got to think they're going to start coming out. They just want to execute right now. They've struggled with a couple of execution plays. Right now they want to come out. They want to execute. Whatever they're calling, they want to run right now.
Well, Matt Kiker's in the shotgun, and he's got nobody in the backfield. And it's a speed sweep coming in motion. That's number 7. And, wow, he's met over there on the sideline by number 55, Watson Kennedy. But not before Elijah Moore was able to pick up a Rebel first down.
Yeah, you got to love that. They decide to spread it out, run the little speed, use the speed on your side. Also, take the ball out of Matt's hands. Let him be able to move the ball around.
Matt Kiker again in the single back shotgun. They're spreading it out again. There's the quick hitter to number 44. I think that's Shannon Edwards. And he picks up a tough 3 or 4 yards. Looks like he was met there by number 58, the big junior defensive end, Malcolm Hughes.
Yeah, you got to love that. We talked about him earlier on, but again, Cameron Bratcher, the nose guard, 6'3", 295. He's just occupying space there in the middle of that defensive line.
Absolutely, and doing a terrific job at doing it. Now we've coming out. Here come the Rebels. They've got it down, second down and 5 in the shotgun.
Blitz is
Kiker
on.
Takers, he's looking for that quick inside slant again. He was looking for number 12, Dallas Kahn, the senior wide out, but it falls incomplete. And as you said, the blitz was on, David. He didn't have time to really get that ball out there. Didn't seem like he had a good handle on it.
No, our young man Colt Carroll, he just came up in there and just snuck right in there right at the time the signal caller was getting the ball up in his hands. Colt Carroll was coming across that offensive line.
And here it is. It's going to be 3rd down and 5 for the Rebels. They've got 2 wideouts to the right. The big man, number 18, Rodriguez McKinney, they might look to go him on a slant here with his size. And there's the snap, and there's the pressure. He's having to roll to the right. He has to tuck it and get what he can, and then he throws it late. And I think they might get him for grounding there, David. He was wrapped up all over the place by number 68, inside linebacker J.D. Bishop.
Yeah, definitely if they don't get him for grounding, it's definitely going to be a hold as that protection broke down. You know, sometimes when you're one of those offensive linemen, it's hard to tell what your quarterback's going to do. So as he scrambled off to his left, I think he might have got a hook in there.
I think you could be right on that. It looks like they're spotting the foul there. So I think that's going to be a grounded call. And yeah, it's loss of down. So it's going to bring up 4th down. And Noah Napier is going to have to punt from his goal line. And he's punting to a dangerous return man, Hunter Glass, who's going to set up shop right at midfield. Volunteers, there's the kick, and the Volunteers look to get great field position out of this. Hunter Glass is just going to back away and let this ball roll, and it's going to roll into Volunteer territory, and that's where the Rebels are down it, about the 42-yard line, but still great field position for Monroe Academy. We've got 10:41 to go in the ball game, and they lead the Rebels 28-0, and David, this is kind of the story of the game here tonight. If I had to guess, the average starting field position for Bessemer Academy is going to be inside the 20, and Monroe seems to start roughly around the 40, 45-yard line.
Absolutely. Great observation again. And that's what it comes down to sometimes, that field position shift.
Absolutely. Now we've got McKenzie's in the shotgun. He's taking a snap, quick handoff to number 11, and then he instantly flips it to number 18, Ethan Nall, who tries to fight back up the middle. He picks up about 3 or 4 yards. Looks like he was brought down there by number 1, and that is Jalen Winston. And also in on the tackle was number 62, Jay Smith, and we've called his name quite a bit tonight.
Yeah, you got to like that. That double handoff, though, trying to do the misdirection, trying to keep Bessemer from not being able to pin their ears back.
And it's 2nd down, McKinney in the shotgun. He's got 2 backs back there, and he hands it off straight on the left side to number 11, running hard. That's Justin Rowell, and he's brought down after a pickup of about 4 yards. Looks like he was met there by Noah Napier and number 68. That is Josh Burrell.
Yeah, and even Dallas Kahn got his head in there that time. Dallas Kahn coming in. Number 12 coming in there. Again, another one of these seniors that you need to get a little leadership out of. He plays a little bit of linebacker, a little bit outside, a little bit of quarterback, a little third string. So he's not afraid to come in there and hit somebody too.
Absolutely not, David. And it's going to bring up 3rd and about 5 for the Volunteers. And McKenzie's in the shotgun. And he takes his big fullback in motion, and he's going to run right behind him. And we've seen them do this several times tonight. But it looks like he's going to be drugged down there by number 24, Sidney Moore, just short of the 1st down. It's going to put the ball right on the midfield stripe, David.
Absolutely. And Noah Napier coming in. Noah creeped up playing kind of like a weak side linebacker position, but he pursuing from the inside out, and he really helped hold that thing up so that we could get some support over there with Sidney Moore. The Volunteers, they're coming right back out. A quick call on the sideline, and here they come.
Absolutely. You're called it, David. Number four, Jake McKenzie, the quarterback. He's in the shotgun with double backs. He's got his big fullback back there with him, Craig Bryan, and let's see what he does. But instead, he's going to hand it to the quick man. That's Justin Rowell, and he busted up the left side. He's still on his feet, folks, and he's finally brought down, but not before he's inside the 10-yard line. Drug down back there. I believe that was Noah Napier that was able to drag him down and make the touchdown-saving tackle, David.
Yeah, him and Jake Merritt trying to react with speed, but we're going to get a couple of people coming into the game right now. Looks like we got Hunter Bobo. He's going to come in. We're going to try to get some folks in there to kind of stop some of that stuff happening.
Absolutely. Some of these guys have been out there for a while. Give them a quick breather. It's first and goal for the Volunteers. They've got the ball on the Rebels' 6-yard line, and they're already leading 28-0 with 8:24 to go in the ball game. This could just about do it here, David. We've got a different quarterback. Blaine Lee's in at quarterback, and he gives the ball right up the gut on a quick handoff, and he powers closer to the goal line. It's going to bring up second and goal and have the ball at about the 2-yard line.
Yeah, it's got to take Justin Rowell over 100 yards for the game with those two big breakdown runs, and plus the stuff that he's done for him today. He's really been a workhorse for the Volunteers.
Absolutely, and just to give you a new, Blaine Lee is the new quarterback. He's a he's actually a ninth grader. So we're getting some experience here. Good time for him to get in the game and start learning this offense. And they're going to give him a chance to score. And he quarterback sneak right up the gut. And he's in for the touchdown, David.
Oh, you got to like that. You got to like the freshman coming in, getting a touch. You got to like that. That bodes well. We talked about the sophomores paying off for dividends long run. You know, here we are. We're coming up. We got 34-0. And the young freshman coming in is able to contribute.
Absolutely, and you always like to see that. And, you know, his mom and dad must be proud. He's a freshman on the varsity football team and getting a touchdown in a big game like this. And here comes the leg, Craig Bryan. If he doesn't already have a nickname, David, I think I'm going to start calling him Craig the Leg. I think I'm going to coin that one. And, well, look at there, David. I think I may have jinxed him. Did I jinx him?
I couldn't tell from here. I can't see from this angle.
Oh, they're calling it good. I thought I jinxed
it. It hit the net. There's a net behind there, and
that's
what kicked it back out.
That ball, Cameron, back 30 yards, folks, up the field off of the net. That's how hard this young man kicks the ball. I tell you what, he's really something special when it comes to a kicker. He's special all around as a player, David. We've seen him running the ball. We've seen him blocking. We've seen him tackling. He kicks off. He punts. He kicks the extra points. He's really, really a valuable player for this team.
Absolutely, and you can tell from his play on the field, he's an unselfish guy. He's not asking for all the touches. He's lead blocking. We've seen him in motion at the flanker position. We'll tally it up for you, folks, but he's probably played 6 or 7 positions tonight.
Absolutely, and we were in the booth earlier at halftime talking with some of the other folks here from the Monroe area. This young man, not only is he a big guy, he's a strong guy. They said he bench presses over 400 pounds, David, and he can clean over 600 pounds. So he's got a lot of muscles in that big frame. Mm. And here's his kick from the 40, and, well, he got under that one a little bit. Bessemer might actually get it. Nope, it's still into the end zone. So he continues the streak. He's 6 for 6 tonight on touchbacks, folks. I thought Shannon Edwards was going to get a chance to return one out there. But once again, the Bessemer Academy Rebels, they're going to set up shop 1st and 10 at their own 20-yard line. We got 7:38 to go in the ball game here. And the Monroe Academy Volunteers lead this game 35-0 over the Bessemer Academy Rebels. We're here in Bessemer, Alabama. You're listening and watching the game on Play On Sports.
PlayOnSports.com is not only your destination for Friday night football action, but it's also the place for the most comprehensive coverage of high school playoff and championship events and all sports from across the country. PlayOnSports.com, high school sports lives here.
We got another change in quarterback, it looks like. David, they're going to bring in Dallas Kahn. The young man's going to take some snaps. He's got two backs in the backfield, and he's going to take the snap. He's going to hand off to Shannon Edwards around the right end. He's running hard, and he picks up about 8 yards before he's brought down over there. Looked like number 16, Caleb Smith, in on the tackle, David.
Yeah, and there's another one of the sensational sophomores from the Bessemer Academy, Shannon Edwards, coming up. Running the ball hard, that's what you want to see. looking at the roster for Monroe Academy, they've got 9 ninth graders on that varsity roster.
Wow. So they're young as well, and they're doing a nice mix and getting some of these younger guys into play. You're starting to see some newer kids in the mix. Dallas Kahn takes the handoff. He hands it to big number 23. That's Jarrell Moore right off the right side. And he's going to be close to the first down. I think he's actually going to have enough to get this one, David. He was met there by that big nose tackle again, number 75, Cameron Bratcher. But I think it was enough for the first down. And there's the signal. Yes, it is. First down, Rebels.
And you got to see, I think we got a timeout or a water break called on the field. I can't see from up here what they're motioning.
But yeah, I believe we do. I think there is a timeout on the field with 6:51 to go in the ballgame. The score is Monroe Academy 35, Bessemer Academy nothing.
You want to stay tuned for the PlayOnSports.com post-game show, where we will select our player of the game, as well as wrap up all the action from this ballgame. That's coming up following the game on your destination for high school sports. It's PlayOnSports.com.
Dallas Kahn takes the snap, and he throws it deep. He's looking for his man, number 2, Jeremy Lacey, but it's just over his head at the 30-yard line. Back there in coverage for the Volunteers was number 15, Cole Griffin, another ninth grader, David.
God, I love it. And you got to love Coach Wright putting the hands in his third-string quarterback's hands, putting the ball in his hands and saying, hey, take a shot down the field. That's the only way we're going to get points on the board.
Absolutely, because I got to tell you, this front four or front six, whatever you want to call it, for the Volunteers, they're really controlling the line of scrimmage. So they're going to have to do something to open this up a little bit because there's just not much there.
That's right. Not much time to make a decision, is there?
Dallas Kahn takes the snap, inside handoff to number 23. That's Jarrell Moore. He runs right into the teeth of that defensive line for the Volunteers, and there's just not much there. He may have fought for a yard, David. There's just not a lot of room to run.
I'm going to tell you the math on that. There was 10 hats in that pile. The only person that didn't get in on that pile was the free safety from Monroe Academy.
Absolutely. And speaking of the free safety, they're going to bring a new one in. They've got number 81, Austin McKinley. He's a 6'1", 165-pound senior coming into the game.
You got to like that. You got to like getting the kids a look. They practice hard all week, too.
Absolutely. And Dallas Kahn's going to stay at quarterback here. He's got his two backs in the backfield. They're spreading it out again. Little high snap. He's looking for that quick hitch. He was looking for number 11, Jake Merritt, but it was overthrown. They were picking on the sideline there. That was number 10, Briar Settle. He slipped in coverage, and pass was just a little bit overthrown. I bet Dallas would like to have that one back, David.
Yeah, you'd think he would. You know, he's going to get just a couple of opportunities here as we're at 5:51 in the fourth quarter, and he wants to make the most of those opportunities.
Absolutely. They're spreading out again. We got two wide to the left and one to the right, and Dallas Kahn's in the shotgun with his two backs. And there's the it's a quick handoff around the left side. That's number 44, Shannon Edwards, and he fights upfield. And he's going to be well short of the first down, David.
Yeah, and I see some laundry over there on that far side of the field, and the ump is going over to talk to the side judge. So as we get ready for this fourth down call, we're coming over. Referee's coming to give us the call now to the home field side. He's going to call holding.
It's a hold against Bessemer, and they're going to decline that because that was the fourth down. So the ball goes over on downs to Monroe Academy.
So it's going to be interesting to see what happens here. You know, you got to think, Monroe, you know, they've got some of their backup players in, but those backup players, they want to play as well, too. They want to score. They want to make a good impression. The freshman quarterback looks like he's going to come back out on the field again.
And it looks like we're going to have a stoppage in play. I think Bessemer is going to call a timeout here and see about maybe getting some more kids in the game, David.
Yeah, either that or they didn't like what they had on the field, one of the two. You got to think, you know, at this point, Coach Wright, he wants to do something to shake things up. He wants to get that goose egg off the scoreboard, and he wants his kids to play hard till the very end of this game.
Absolutely, and you gotta love the heart and grit and determination that these young men are showing in this ball game. I mean, it would be very easy just to, roll over and lay down when you're down 35-0, but they're continuing to fight and scrap just as hard as they can. It shows a lot about what they're learning as young men on this football field.
Absolutely. You got to know these coaches teach much more than the X's and O's. They care as much about the Jimmies and the Joes as they do the X's and the O's.
Well put, David. Well put. Absolutely. They're going over a couple things here, but you can tell there's a couple guys on that Bessemer in that Bessemer huddle there. You can tell they're gassed. I mean, they've went all night long, and they're just about out of gas, it seems like.
Yeah, and, you know, that happens with the momentum, too. You know, it's amazing how the scoreboard can affect the emotions of these young men. You know, it's 35-0. The same young men on the other side have been playing the same ways, both ways, same amount of time. But that momentum, that scoreboard really shifts the attitude.
Absolutely, absolutely it does. And Bessemer Academy has been in a couple holes tonight, and they've had a couple of opportunities. They had the ball first and goal, you know, inside the 10-yard line, and, you know, a couple mishandled snaps, and then on the next play it was a turnover, and that's tough.
Yeah, absolutely. And we even talked about, you know, some of the pass interference calls and block in the back. Remember they had the nice return down here. The block in the back, it kind of shifted that field position. You made a great point earlier on, Steve, to talk about the starting field position has been in the favor of Monroe Academy. And, you know, when you're playing on a short field all night long, it makes it a little easier for you to put up 35 points.
It does, it does. And we saw, I mean, when they're getting the ball around midfield, they're wanting to go for the big hit. And, I mean, and you called that, you know, you called that earlier. You said if they get the opportunity – they've got a quarterback with a strong arm, and they're not scared to use it. There's no doubt about it.
We definitely want you to stay tuned with us. We want you to stay tuned for PlayOnSports.com postgame show. That's where Steve and I will bring it to you. We'll select our player of the game, as well as we'll wrap up all the action from this ball game. That's coming up following the game on your destination for high school sports, PlayOnSports.com. I got to tell you, Steve, they've been great hosts here. We've been in Rebel Country tonight at Bessemer Academy, and they've done nothing but treat us well.
Absolutely. They put us in a nice press box, folks. We're actually we're in the air condition here. We don't have a – with the exception of our cameraman, Charlie, who's out there in the heat and the bugs doing a great job. Charlie's the one that's actually bringing you the game. He's doing a great job. We've got Mark, our producer, up here with us as well, doing a fantastic job bringing you the videos and getting everything to you. And we've got a great crew here, and we're glad to be here bringing you high school football on Friday night for PlayOnSports.com.
Hey, Steve, you were talking about at the beginning of the game about the last time these two met, Bessemer Academy and Monroe Academy, they met in the playoffs, and you were talking about that carryover. How much of that do you think inspired Monroe Academy to come out here and put on this kind of performance?
I think a lot. I mean, you know, you and I talked about that, David, in the beginning. It's tough to beat a team three times in a row. I mean, that third time, they're really wanting to prove something to you. They've got a chip on their shoulder. And, you know, we talked about it. The Rebels are young. I mean, they're young. There's no doubt about it. And there's the Volunteers take the snap, and they're I think they're content to hand it off. That's a fresh face in the game. That's number 14. That's Caleb Sessions. He's a ninth grade running back. So we've got a lot of ninth graders in here playing right now, David, and that's nice to see. You don't build a quality program like Coach Tuberville has over at Monroe Academy without continuing to be able to filter these kids in and get them some experience in times like this so they're ready when you need them next year.
Absolutely.
And there's Lee. He's giving the handoff, and he hands it off to number 14, and he just doesn't have anywhere to go. That's Caleb Sessions again, and he's caught behind the line by number 15, Matt Kiker, and number 7, Elijah Moore. Stuff that out there, David.
Yeah, you got to like that. You know, as the freshmen are coming in trying to make their impact right now, Bessemer Academy still has their starters on the field. They're going to stretch out those kind of plays. Bessemer Academy has showed great speed running side to side. Their Achilles heel has been in the middle of their defense. But running side to side, these guys, Elijah Moore, number 24, Sidney Moore, they are flying around the ball.
Absolutely, and you made the point earlier, David. First to play here, that's a direct snap to the quarterback. He hands off. That's number 44, Dallas Nichols, another ninth grader. So we've got a lot of ninth graders in here for the Volunteers. But back to your point earlier, David, you were talking about they wanted to, you made a great point of, they want to test that middle and test that middle. And the way they've been spreading this thing out, they hammered that middle and hammered that middle until they softened it up and they found some holes in there.
That's right. And that's part of the chess match we talked about early on.
Blaine Lee's back under. He's in shotgun, and he takes a direct snap, and he goes right up that middle we were just talking about, and he picks up about 4 yards. And that was fourth down. I'm sorry. I thought that was going to bring up fourth down. So that was fourth down for the Volunteers. So they turn it over to Bessemer Academy on downs. And we got 3:53 to go in the ball game here, folks. And Bessemer Academy is going to have the ball first and 10. And it looks like they're going to mark that at the Rebels 30-yard line.
Yeah, you gotta think right now. With 3:53 left to go in the fourth quarter, Coach Wright, they're going to try to take and put their players on the field. They're going to try to take that goose egg off the scoreboard right now. Offensive coordinator Randy Thomas, he's up there. He's seen this. He's seen what they're doing. He's really going to try to exploit that here with under 4 minutes left to go in the game.
Absolutely, and the Rebels come back on the field and trying to see. We've got Dallas Kahn still going to be at quarterback. Looks like he may be going under center here. We're going to have a different look. They're going under center in the I formation. They're going to have two wide outs, more of a pro-style set we've got here this time. And Rebels aren't sure of that, David. They're going to call a timeout and talk about this thing.
Yeah, and you got to like that. Number 63 is their freshman center. They've got Trevor is out there right now. Trevor Flack, 6'1", 250-pound center, and he's their ninth grader. So he's when Dallas Kahn steps underneath center, he's got the big freshman trying to protect him tonight.
Absolutely. And so it looks like the Rebels are going to talk this over. And we've seen a couple of different looks for them and as far as formations go tonight, David. And I think down the road later this year, I think that's a benefit that they'll be able to go some of these things. They've got I think they got some issues to work out with their under center snaps. And but other than that, I still believe they're a solid ball team.
Absolutely. I would definitely agree with that assessment. Solid ball club. Like we said, some of the turnovers may make it seem like it was a sloppy game, but it definitely wasn't. We just had athletes making plays on balls tonight.
Absolutely. And you know, Bessemer Academy is young. They're young. Of course, we know Monroe is young, but they do have a lot of senior-laden, you know, leadership to start the game. Now they've got some of their ninth graders in. But Charlie Kahn's under center, or Dallas Kahn, excuse me, to take this snap, and it's a toss. First time we've seen that tonight, to number 44. That's Shannon Edwards, and a nice-looking play there on the toss. We haven't seen that yet tonight. Just a different look, and it picks up. Might be enough for a first down, David. Let's see. If not, it's going to be right on the sticks. I'm waiting for the referee to mark it off. And he's going to be a little bit shorter than I thought. It's going to bring up second down and two, but their Bessemer Academy's giving them a different look here. The Rebels are under center with a single back now. And there's the snap. Quick hit to the fullback right off the belly. He fights, and I think he's going to have enough for the first down, David.
Yeah, I definitely think he made it right up into that belly to get what he needed. That's big 23, Jarrell Moore, coming up 5'9", 230-pounder. The freshman coming off the end, Cole Griffin, number 15 for Monroe Academy, coming up trying to stop some of those sweeps. I'm really impressed. These freshmen, too, they're coming in towards the late, you know, kind of mop-up duty at the end of this game, but they're definitely coming in and cracking heads.
Yeah, they're not scared to make their name for themselves, that's for sure. Back under center, we've got a fullback, and they're in the eye, and there's the toss to Shannon Edwards again, and he's still rumbling and breaking tackles, and picks up about 6 yards before he's brought down there. Who's rolling out of that pile? Who's on the bottom there? That's number
38, number 74.
74, we haven't called his name tonight. That's Alex Robinson, another ninth grader. Imagine that, David. Wow, you thought these guys had a lot of seniors. Well, they've got a lot of ninth graders, too, and they sure can play.
Yeah, they're coming out to play. They're coming out to hit it. You don't want to see Shannon Edwards coming up a little bit gimpy after that pile play. He's coming over to the side, and looks like he's hampered by a right knee injury.
Absolutely. He is coming off the field there. And
looks like he's missing a shoe.
The Rebels are going to come up to the line, and they're going back under center, and they're in the eye. And they got the big fullback back there. That's number 23, Jarrell Moore. And they're going to throw from this, and there's a completion for the first down. That was Dallas Kahn throwing out there on the right side. It looks like he was hitting number, says it's number 14, but I don't have a number 14 on my roster there.
Yeah, I'm David. With you. We apologize to that young man. We can't get his name out there, but he made a great catch.
Great catch
back
and a big first down. It's going to give the Rebels the ball inside Volunteer territory. They've got it first and 10 on the Monroe Academy 46-yard line. We've got 2:10 to go in the ball game. The score is 35-0 in favor of Monroe Academy. And they're going to run that toss again around the right side. Nice yardage. Nice yardage. That was a toss play to number 9. Yet another mystery man, David. Our roster's done a great job for us tonight, and it's starting to fail us a little bit now.
Yeah, and some of that just as we get deeper into the roster, maybe some of these younger players just coach just doesn't have them, you know, and it, midway through the season, yeah, it's still some clerical stuff to work out.
Absolutely, absolutely. And nice run there by number 9, and we do apologize to his proud mom and pop. I'm sure he made a great run, and we'll see if we can't get his name for you. Dallas Kahn brings him back up to the line. It's going to be first and 10, 1:30 to go in the ball game. He's under center when he's got his they're in the eye. He's going to fake the toss and a naked bootleg, and it is snuffed out beautifully by Cole Griffin. Boy, I got to tell you, these ninth graders, David, they've watched their senior members, and they've picked up this defense quite nicely.
Yeah, I tell you, that was assignment football right there. Cole Griffin had contained on the far side of the field. He didn't bite on the fake toss coming to the short side, and as Dallas Kahn spun to come up out of that naked bootleg, Cole Griffin was just there right on him.
Absolutely great play by Cole Griffin. Play's gonna lose 2 or 3 yards. It's gonna bring up second, and we'll call it 12 from the 38-yard line. Quick handoff. There's that man again, number 9. He's gonna get back just over the original line of scrimmage. And I'm not sure, David, if that's not going to be our final play of the ball game. There's just under 30 seconds to go, and it's going to bring up third and we'll call it 9 for the Rebels.
Yeah.
It looks like they're going to try to hustle and get another playoff here, David.
Yeah, they're going to try to. They got less than 20 seconds to go. They're definitely going to get one more off.
This is barring a penalty or an incomplete pass, I'm sure this is going to be our last play of the game. And Dallas Kahn's under center. He takes the snap. It's a toss to number 9. He goes right up the gut. Nice run. Nice run. He actually picks up the first down. And that stops the clock because there's a first down and there's 0.8 seconds left. But it looks like the coaches are making their way onto the field, coach. And I think we're gonna call this one a day. Oh, no, they've called a timeout. Well, they're going to run those 0.8 off. And that's your ball game, folks. Final score tonight from Bessemer, Alabama. The visiting Monroe Academy Volunteers 35 and the homestanding Bessemer Academy Rebels 0. And, ladies and gentlemen, we invite you to stay tuned to playonsports.com for our postgame coverage. We'll wrap up all the action in our postgame show, and we'll have an interview with our player of the game. That's coming up in just a few moments. Once again, the Monroe Academy Volunteers have defeated the Bessemer Academy Rebels 35-0 on Friday Night Football on playonsports.com, your destination for high school sports.
We can get a player up here.
Oh, that's good stuff.
All right, perfect. Prepare a Wiley Ballard graphic.
Do you want me to start the stream?
Start the stream.
Camera 3.
Beautiful. Oh, we're coming in on 1.
For more information on how your school can join the Play On School broadcast program, go to playonsports.com/SBP.
4th and 10 from the 41-yard line for St. Augustine. Kennedy dropping back to pass. Looking left, firing, incomplete, okay. Intended for Nolan. No penalty flags on the field. Mar Vista will take over on downs. And Jordan Lertique will take that knee. And the Mar Vista Mariners knock off the number two seeded St. Augustine Saints at Mesa College in a dominating performance on both sides of the football for Mar Vista. They trailed 14-0 and came back.
Again, down 2-0, facing adversity, and they've really just turned the table around since game number three. Set an attack, great block made back inside the Maverick zone. A chance there by Bosback back inside the Maverick zone. Ball attacked there by Bosback. A second opportunity by Bosback. Lift violation call. Winner. Oh. It's an over the net call. Oh my goodness. Bosback reached over on the attack. A Maverick error wraps up the title for the Presentation Panthers. A 15-9 victory in game number five, and they wrap it up coming back from 2-0 down match-wise and take it 3-2.
36-35 and driving. And oh, baby! Shrigley with the jam, and it was with emphasis. And it's the foul, and listen to these fans.
Do you know who's standing up right behind us? Tony.
Hand me that.
All right, folks. Welcome to the PlayOnSports.com postgame show. We're working on getting an interview with our player of the game from Bessemer Academy. It's Jeremy Lacey. He's a 6'1", 175-pound junior. Played outstanding tonight on special teams. This was a matchup between two big rivals in the AISA rankings, the 3A class rankings in the state of Alabama. And from about midway through the first quarter on, it was pretty much all the volunteers from Monroe Academy. They had lost twice to this Rebel team last year, once during the regular season and once during the playoffs. They came out tonight with something to prove, and they did. The final score here tonight was 35-0 in favor of the Volunteers. They were able to throw the ball, run the ball. The only thing they had a couple of turnovers. They had a punt blocked. Other than that, this was a great ball game, great ball game. A lot closer than the 35-0 score, that's for sure. These two teams, I'm sure it's not the last time they'll meet. It was a hard-fought game. Bessemer Academy's really young on both sides of the ball. The senior quarterback for Monroe Academy, Jake McKenzie, was able just to he was effectively running the offense tonight, and they, like I said, put up 35 points on the board. Very little mistakes on either side of the ball. And Bessemer Academy will come back next week bigger and stronger, I'm sure. We hope you'll stay tuned with us on the PlayOnSports.com postgame show as we have a live interview with our player of the game, Jeremy Lacey of the Bessemer Academy Rebels. That's coming up next on your destination for high school sports, PlayOnSports.com.
We can get a player up here.
Oh, that's good stuff.
All right, perfect. Prepare a Wiley Ballard graphic.
Do you want me to start the stream?
Start the stream.
Camera three.
Beautiful.
Oh, we're coming in on one.
For more information on how your school can join the Play On School broadcast program, go to playonsports.com/SBP.
Fourth and 10 from the 41-yard line for St. Augustine. Kennedy dropping back to pass. Looking left. Firing, incomplete, okay. Intended for Noland. No penalty flags on the field. Mar Vista will take over on downs, and Jordan Lertik will take that knee. And the Mar Vista Mariners knock off the number two seeded St. Augustine Saints at Mesa College in a dominating performance on both sides of the football for Mar Vista. They trailed 14-0 and came back.
Again, down 2-0, facing adversity, and they've really just turned the table around since game number three. Set an attack, great block made back inside the Maverick zone. A chance there by Bosback back inside the Maverick zone. Ball attacked there by Bosback. A second opportunity by Bosback. Lift violation call. Winner.
Oh.
It's all over the...
over the net call. Oh, my goodness. Bosbach reached over on the attack. A Maverick error wraps up the title for the Presentation Panthers. A 15-9 victory in game number 5. And they wrap it up coming back from 2-0 down match-wise and take it 3-2.
36-35 and driving. And oh, baby! Shrigley with the jam, and it was with emphasis. And it's the foul, and listen to these fans.
Do you know who's standing up right behind us? Tony Bland, who is the head recruiter for San Diego State. I think he's drooling. Somebody get that man a napkin.
Quick score on this drive. There goes a handoff to Zeller trying to go straight ahead, but he is met by Wall. Now he breaks out to the outside, gets across the 30, 35, on the right, 40, midfield. He's running down the sidelines. He's going to go all the way as he's at the 10, 5, touchdown. Patrick Zeller got, he stood up at the line of scrimmage and broke out to his left to the far sidelines, and he was in a foot race, and he went all the way for the touchdown, broke a tackle, and made it nice and showed his speed as he got outside for the touchdown.
Back in the backfield to the left is Campbell. Hernandez takes the snap, play action to Campbell. Looks down the field. Now here comes the pressure. He's going to be hit. He breaks the tackle, rolls left. Now he's going to cut up field. He's going to break another tackle, and then another tackle down the sideline. Gets a block inside the 5. What a touchdown! Hernandez goes 33 yards in spectacular fashion, breaking 4 tackles along the way, including 2 in the backfield, and Hilltop has tied this one up at 29.
Grant with a big, strong defensive rebound. He brings it back down the floor again in another slam.
We good? Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and we're back to the post-game wrap-up for PlayOnSports.com's Friday night football game. I'm here with Jeremy Lacey, our player of the game for the Bessemer Academy Rebels. Jeremy, tell us a little bit about the game tonight.
The game was really good. It's I think our team fought hard. Monroe has a really good team, and they we tried to fight. We lost our running back, Chris, and we didn't let us get it down.
Yeah, can you give us an update on Chris? We noticed he came off the field. Have you guys heard anything at all?
We haven't heard anything. We know he went to the hospital, and we just hope the best for him.
Well, I'll tell you, we brought you up here tonight because we noticed you all night long on special teams. You're a gunner on the punt coverage. You're a return man. You made a couple great plays. You got a couple of penalties that really kind of hemmed you up, but overall, we thought you did a great job on special teams. Is that something you take pride in?
Yes, I love special teams. It's one of my favorites, and every time I get a chance to step out there, I try my hardest to go block it or whatever I need to do.
Now, how will you guys bounce back from this? How will you guys deal with this adversity?
Well, we're just going to come back in Monday and just fight and do it all over again and get back to the drawing boards.
Go back to work, huh?
Yes, sir.
Well, Jeremy, we appreciate you joining us tonight.
Yes,
great ball game. You're our player of the game, and we thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
All right, have a good night. All right, folks, that was Jeremy Lacey, our player of the game for the Bessemer Academy Rebels. Don't go anywhere. The PlayOnSports.com postgame show will continue in just a few moments on PlayOnSports.com, your destination for high school sports.
We can get a player up here.
Oh, that's good stuff.
Perfect. Prepare a Wiley Ballard graphic.
Do you want me to start the stream?
Start the stream.
Camera 3.
Beautiful.
Oh, we're coming in on 1.
For more information on how your school can join the Play On School broadcast program, go to playonsports.com/SBP.
4th and 10 from the 41-yard line for St. Augustine. Kennedy dropping back to pass. Looking left, firing, incomplete, intended for Noland. No penalty flags on the field. Mar Vista will take over on downs, and Jordan Lertique will take that knee And the Mar Vista Mariners knock off the number two seeded St. Augustine Saints at Mesa College in a dominating performance on both sides of the football for Mar Vista. They trailed 14-0 and came back.
Again, down 2-0, facing adversity, and they've really just turned the table around since game number three. Set an attack, great block made back inside the Maverick zone. A chance there by Bosback back inside the Maverick zone. Ball attacked there by Bosback. A second opportunity by Bosback. Lift violation call. Winner. Oh. It's an over the net call. Oh my goodness.
Welcome back to Bessemer, Alabama, and the PlayOnSports.com postgame show. I'm Steve Hall alongside David Sauls, and we just saw the Monroe Academy Volunteers defeat the Bessemer Academy Rebels by a score of 35-0. David, this was two AISA 3A powerhouses, and I know Bessemer Academy won the last two matchups, but clearly Monroe Academy got the best of it tonight.
Absolutely, and you got to be impressed with the youngsters that both of these teams put on the field tonight. The sensational sophomores that Bessemer threw out there, and the freshmen that came on in mop-up duty there for Monroe Academy. It shows that they're growing the program the right way. They've got some feeder talent coming in there, and they're going to sustain some success down the road.
Absolutely, and there were a couple big plays in the first half for a 14-0 Monroe Academy lead. We thought Bessemer could maybe do some things in the second half, and first play out of the gate, big long touchdown from Jake McKenzie, and it boom instantly 21-0. And then from that point, I think Bessemer Academy was just overmatched.
Yeah, and I think they had some key injuries too. Injuries are a part of the game, but. You heard during your interview that you had with Jeremy Lacey, the player of the game, he brought up, we lost Chris. I think he even called him our best player. So when they see one of their brothers go down, there comes two things that happens. Either you rally around that and it gives you a little emotional boost, or it takes the wind out of your sails and then go right behind that and you lose your starting quarterback. Remember, Bessemer Academy was to their third string quarterback, and that wasn't because of desire. That's because they had to have him out there.
Absolutely. That's a great point you make, David. And, Bessemer Academy is a young team this year. We see that. And we definitely know that, Coach Wright will have these guys back and ready to go again next week and definitely for the future. Both these programs have been around a long time, been very successful. They got, 11 state championships between the two of them? I mean, that tells you right there, like you said, you made a great point. They build it the right way, and they start with these ninth graders, and they work their way up. And, Bessemer had won the last two matchups, and we talked about it at the opening of the telecast tonight, how hard it is to beat a team three times in a row. That's just when you're an evenly matched team, as we saw, coming into tonight, Monroe only led the series. They played 11 times. Monroe's won six. Bessemer Academy's won five. I mean, these are two evenly matched teams. We saw them both run the spread-style offense. There's a lot of similarities between these two schools. There's no doubt about it, David.
Yeah, absolutely. And when you think about what they're doing from that, seeing it all week long and then coming out and executing on Friday nights, one of the great things that I was able to hear Coach Tuberville say is he had both teams together. He said to both teams, this was a classy, hard-fought contest. Even Coach Wright, he was with his boys. He told them, I'm so proud of you. You didn't quit fighting, and that's important. So as you look at these two things, 35-0, it'd be easy to pack it in and say you don't want to run with that anymore. But I could tell you right now, they didn't do that. They decided that they wanted to take and run this thing. And they fought hard. They fought hard. There's no doubt it's a 48-minute contest. And 48 minutes into this thing, Bessemer Academy Rebels were still fighting. They fought the whole way through it. I tell you another thing that was really impressive about it, Steve, the adjustments that Coach Tuberville was making during the course of the game. We've seen him go to a 6-2 defense. We watched Bessemer try to counter that by putting 8 and 9 in the box to stop the run. And when they did that, Monroe made them pay. They went to those quick outs and they went to some of those passes because they knew they were in man coverage. So you got to love the chess match that happened between the two coaches tonight.
Absolutely. You couldn't be more dead on with your comments, David. And, you know, this was our first game to work together, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. You did an outstanding job. It was a fantastic night. And that's going to wrap it up for us folks tonight here in Bessemer, where the Monroe Academy Volunteers defeated the Bessemer Academy Rebels 35-0. We'd like to thank you for joining PlayOnSports.com's coverage of Friday Night Football from Bessemer, Alabama. Be sure to check PlayOnSports.com for information and links to all of our upcoming broadcasts. For our producer, Mark Morosky, our videographer, Charlie Barrett, and my partner, David Sauls, I'm Steve Hall saying so long, and we hope you'll join us next Friday night on your destination for high school sports and Friday Night Football. PlayOnSports.com.